Ashley Village was raided this morning. People were killed. They're saying it was us.
What is going on?
I don't know. But I mean to find out. If the villagers turn against us, we're in trouble.
Was much of Marion?
She's been gone since morning.
We must find them.
This is Bristol. It's Friday. It's 5 o'clock. And welcome to Not the BCFM Politics Show on the 1st of March, officially the beginning of spring 2024. Streaming live from the People's Republic of Stokes Croft Arts Centre in Bristol on the talkradio.org.uk stream and at radioquk.com in Camberley, Surrey, and live on Not the BCFM Politics Show app, available free from all good app stores. Aurora, please, rather than Google. And hopefully we're sounding a little bit less bathroom-like this week, so we've got a little bit of sound baffling has appeared in the studio, along with the words K-U-M, although I'm not quite sure what that's supposed to mean. These are the new people who occupy this space and apparently pay more for it than we do. So they get to call the tune. Funny enough, I wonder where they get their funding from. Anyway, I'm Tony Gosling. Thank you for turning off the psycho in the corner, gaslighting us with its military-grade propaganda psyops, puff pieces on the conspirators and hatchet jobs on the heroes. McCarthyite witch hunts going on after anyone with influence who speaks up for humanity and against the World War III wage slavery lies. For those with eyes to see and ears to hear, those so-called solutions to every crisis, Gaza, Ukraine, COVID, migrants, farming, cost of living, climate, stacking up nicely there, aren't they? The twisted accelerationist Armageddonist policies designed to make every crisis worse. And the politicians, as Manfred Petrich used to say, have nothing to say. Well, let's see, maybe there might be one just suddenly popped up into the Houses of Parliament today that may have something to say. Just to let you know as well, by the way, I'm not really playing excerpts right or anything like that, but on Tuesday I was very kindly asked to give a talk, and a Q&A afterwards at the old convent in Stroud by the Project Libertas people down there about accelerationism. This is something I've been getting my head around over the last couple of years, as you might have noticed, talking more and more about it. Something that David Halpin calls Armageddonism, I think, is a better way to put it. And so I did an hour and a quarter, and then we had half an hour's Q&A over in Stroud this week. So I'll pop a link up to that on our show page at thisweek.org.uk tonight as well, if you fancy listening to that. But I'm not going to be putting it on the show. That we will leave to the likes of David Livingstone to talk a bit about the background to it all. So Nick Land's behaviourist dark enlightenment drones, the cowards and control freaks, want us as slaves to their machines. Huxley's diabolical plan rewards only blind obedience. Didn't you know that? Meanwhile, pantheist wife-murdering WEF King Tampon Charlie wages war on the British people, as well as China, Russia and the BRICS, with regime change maniac sidekick. Maybe that's the Dick Dastardly and Muttley we were talking about last week, Martin. That's King Charles and Diddy David Cameron. So, joining us to navigate the World Economic Forum's Fourth Industrial Revolution, the Fourth Reich Matrix, is Irish Republican Labour activist Martin Summers. This week, we will talk about the Bristol's new gay Labour MP, who's married apparently to an Israeli agent. We were going to talk about that last week. And joining us at six to discuss yesterday's Workers' Party by-election victory in Rochdale is Steve Hall. He's the author of The Death of the Left and one of the activists within the Workers' Party. So, Iranian and Russian news banned in the UK, first by the telecoms cartel and then by Ofcom. Us cancelled off Bristol Community FM by the Bristol Mafia, but not cancelled here yet, thank God. So, Martin, first of all, we will be talking more about this with Steve Hall after six, but it's quite significant, isn't it? George Galloway winning by quite a thumping majority in Rochdale last night.
Yeah, I mean, obviously he will, and the Workers' Party will all be happy with it. The Labour Party did very badly, as they, you know, they were bound to do, because they basically get, you know, threw the towel in and decided that
they weren't the only ones that threw the towel in. It's almost as if there was a conspiracy to get George Galloway elected by both Labour and the Greens. So the Labour Party, they condemned their own candidate, and the Green Party too condemned their own candidate. So many of the other opposition on the left were out of the game.
Well, that's right. And Galloway is a well-known figure, and he's done this by kind of by-election lightning attack before. So there was definitely, you know, there was every chance that he was going to be a winner here, and he was. And of course, there's a very low turnout.
Turnout is higher, though, than the last week's or week before last's by-elections. I can't remember where they were now, where Labour won.
Well, that's right.
This is a higher one. I think it's probably because it's been quite politically charged, Rochdale.
Yeah, well, in the past, by-elections used to have bigger turnouts in, than general elections sometimes, because it was, you know, it's one chance you've got in a particular community for when everybody's watching.
I know you're going to hate me saying it, but, you know, the Brexit referendum got one of the highest turnouts we've seen since the 1970s.
Yeah.
Because people felt it was actually meant something.
Yes, okay, but, I mean, the point is that, you know, in Australia, everybody has to vote because it's compulsory. So it's a system that we have in this country which allows turnout to determine results.
Yeah, listening to some of the Vox Pops this morning, a lot of people saying, well, it doesn't make any difference who you vote for. None of them really care about us. So that is the kind of meme that's been going around, I think, a lot.
Well, that's actually quite destructive, because that is exactly what the deep state, if you like, wants. So they can then stitch up the actual voting situation. I mean, it's a big victory for George Galloway. You know, he's a big fish in a small pond. But in the bigger picture, he's going to become a voice for powerfully left sentiments in Parliament, but he won't be able to do anything because he'll be blocked out by the system, because the system's designed to block people like him out.
You know what? That sounds like the European Parliament.
Well, it sounds like any parliament. Because most
not all parliaments, no. Some of them
were actually
quite lively.
Well, the Icelandic parliament were able to do quite a bit.
How about the Russian parliament?
Ah, yeah. Well, the Russian parliament, don't forget, you've got a presidential system in Russia. So there's a big question about what the relationship between the parliament and the president is. The similar problem in France. Because France, Macron doesn't have a majority in the National Assembly,
anyway,
which is why can't
Galloway's
get
overturned
done.
What was nearly 10,000 Labour majority. That's pretty impressive, isn't it? Really?
I think what he's done is he's swept up the traditional Labour vote. Because the Labour Party themselves have decided that they don't want it for some reason best known to themselves.
Well, you know why.
Well, I know, it's because what they could have done is they could have defended their candidate, saying it's a legitimate comment to say that the Israelis may have allowed this thing to happen. And of course, even the people that are saying that they've got it wrong are saying, well, you can't say things like that. That's absurd. I'm quite sure George Galloway, when he gets to Parliament, will be able to raise questions about the Israelis let it happen.
Yeah,
it's just a factual matter about which there can be factual disagreements, surely.
Very different, our own mayor, and we'll be hearing a bit from him and about his future career. A bit later on in the programme. But on this whole business of LIHOP, where do you stand on it on October the 7th? Did the Israelis deliberately either reduce their defences, stand down or anything like that in order to... Because this was actually what this by-election victory for Galloway over the Labour Party is all about, because the Labour Party's candidate said, I believe it's possible that the Israeli government and the Israeli Defence Forces stood down to a certain extent on the 7th of October to allow this attack to take place, and it gave them an excuse to clear Gaza. So by saying that, apparently he's being accused of anti-Semitism and he's been drummed out of the party.
Yes, and I think the message has been given at the ballot box in Rochdale that people aren't prepared to be told what to think. Galloway, I'm quite sure, is aware of these allegations. In Israel itself, these allegations are openly discussed. Ehud Olmert, who used to be the Prime Minister of Israel, he wrote a piece which I read yesterday, which is basically attacking the Israeli government on exactly those kind of lines. So it's only in Britain that you're not allowed to say these things. In Israel, you can, and people
why
do.
Why does it matter more in Britain than it does in Israel? That's bizarre.
It's because in Britain we've got what it's to do with is the kind of control the Zionist deep state has over our politics, and that includes the United States. The big thing in Britain is not to find a cigarette paper with the United States. And that's been always the problem in this country since 1945.
Yeah, another
and it dwarfs Brexit as an issue of national sovereignty completely.
Something else that's just popped up, which I say popped up, but it's popped into my head, which we must discuss later. Absolutely must. I'm going to write it down with a pen. I have to do that, I'm afraid, otherwise I'll probably forget. Is this release this week from TASS and the Russian Foreign Ministry about the use of lethal chemical weapons by the by the Ukrainians on the Eastern Front? I don't know if you'd seen that this week.
Well, I do follow it quite closely, and yes, they're doing. What's happening now is because they're losing the bat on the battlefield. Their British advisers, and I think they are British advisers. And did you see Kitson died in January?
Oh, yes.
And there's very interesting stuff about him. But they're going now for what you might call a special forces strategy, where they blow stuff up inside Russia, assassinate people, use chemical weapons, and then try and blame
it on the Russians. SAS behind the lines, or something.
Yes, all of that stuff, and they see themselves as you know, very, very good at this kind of tricky stuff. But of course, it is all quite literally illegal, even when you're at war, to do things like this. If you get caught, you get caught. And of course, the Russians are not going to be deterred by this, but they're very well aware that that's what they're going to throw at them. And of course, if what they could do is retaliate in kind. But of course, if they did that, that would then play into the hands of the war hawks in the West.
Yeah, the Russian Foreign Ministry is saying that these are basically like crowd control substances, but they've had other things which are more lethal mixed in with them. So, you know, obviously things like pepper spray, but this is much more. They've got what they've done is analysis in their labs to find that actually there's also substances in there which do things like induce heart attacks, this kind of thing.
Well, I mean,
that they're being sprayed by drones over the Russian troops, and they've now got hold of captured papers over the last week or so, which show that they specially ordered these drones, which can dispense aerosol sprays up to 20 litres of them.
Yes, and of course the other thing is that they've been doing throughout the conflict is they've been engineering supposed chemical weapons attacks by the Russians, because that's supposedly one of the things in the rat maze we're in. You can press that button, chemical weapons attack, and all these people go, oh no, we must attack them. And it's, you know, we're reaching, the West has got totally enmeshed in its own psychological warfare operation. The only thing they have is further lies and the creation of even more abstractly baroque plots. And of course, the Skripal plot wasn't the Russians, it was our intelligence services. It's just basic stuff that people can't get. The people that are doing a lot of the stuff, Al-Qaeda was created by our intelligence services. And there was a very good article about Kitson on Consortium News this week by Mick Hall, who's a New Zealand journalist, going into all the ins and outs of the skullduggery which he bequeathed to the British Army Special Forces. And it's basically dirty tricks of every kind. And that's all we're good for. We can't actually win tank battles against the Russians. It's laughable.
Well, maybe that's all you need these days. You don't need to win those tank battles.
Well, that's turned out to be a big miscalculation, don't you think?
If you can destroy the infrastructure behind the scenes, if you can assassinate leaders behind the scenes or behind the lines, why do you need to win a tank battle?
Well, yes, but it's the weapons of the weak. You know, and in actual fact, what the Russians are demonstrating is that old-fashioned warfare, where you mobilise hundreds of thousands of people who know what they're doing using state-of-the-art kit, has not gone away.
Okay, so we're going to talk about the LIHOP in Gaza to begin with, not the normal local stuff, the tree forum or anything like that. And just came across this yesterday. It's from something called Syriana Analysis, which is an excellent, I think the guy's German, I'm not sure. Anyway, he's brilliant. But of course, one of the nice things about him is he doesn't waffle on like me or Martin. What he does is he just lets Whitney Webb explain it.
I think it was a let it happen style event. And, there were a lot of comparisons made by Israeli officials at the time saying this is our 9/11, right? And for those that have researched seriously, September 11th, 2001 in New York City, people that have looked into that are aware that the same sophisticated system, not the same, but sophisticated defense systems in the U.S. all just happened not to be working that day. How convenient. And they were tied to a series of software companies, P-Tech, for example, among others, that had ties to, intelligence, and involved in various things that were very suspect. Just like October 7th, there was advanced knowledge and insider trading taking place before the attacks themselves, showing that someone with money and means knew that those attacks were going to happen before they did. So foreknowledge, right? And then you have to consider, too, that what was going on in Israel before October 7th, extreme protest against Netanyahu in Israel over the judicial reform issue. How do you bring together a divided populace, particularly in Israel? You unite them with war, a common enemy, a common threat. And so by, you know, I mean, you know, in Israel, a lot of people say that Americans are the most propagandized populace. I would say it's Israel is definitely up there, if not above the U.S., because, you know, the Ministry of Education is increasingly is often run by the same people that also like have top posts in the Ministry of Defense. Naftali Bennett, for example, a good example of the overlap there. And there's a lot of, you know, Israelis in many kindergartens and, you know, early education are basically taught that, you know, you live in an insecure place because you're Jewish and people are going to come after you. And, you know, we're a persecuted populace and all of this stuff. And Israel, since its inception in the late 40s, has been under a state of emergency continuously in its entire existence. It's never not been in a state of emergency. And so this whole like instantaneous wartime footing is sort of ingrained in this particular population and has been for some time. And so a way to stop, I think, in my opinion, October 7th was so convenient in that it stopped a lot of those problems for Netanyahu and then allowed him to sort of, you know, unify the issues, the different factions against him, essentially, and then push for longstanding objectives of his, which include things like ethnic cleansing of what remains of Palestine, and, you know, greater Israel ambitions and regional wars with various nations for the goal of, you know, greater Israel territorial acquisition. And Netanyahu in his current government is allied with figures that want to actualize that as well, not just Netanyahu, and have been a lot more vocal about those goals than Netanyahu himself, as particularly the greater Israel aspect of it. Yeah. But Netanyahu more recently has said things like Israel needs to control from the river to the sea. And all of that, meaning like all of the territory, and has, you know, even his officials ever since the, you know, the conflict in Gaza has begun, has been very open about the goal is to essentially remove Gazans from Gaza and wanting to send them to the Sinai, resettle them in the Sinai, and all of these other agendas that have been developed, you know, well before October 7th. You know, my colleague Ian Davis wrote a very excellent article breaking down all of the supposed intelligence failures of October 7th and how it is very much, you know, seems to have been intentional. The AI aspect, did AI fail? Yes, maybe in some cases AI does fail because there is no facial recognition AI algorithm on the market that's 100% accurate.
Yeah.
And there's some countries like the UK, for example, where there have been scandals essentially about how inaccurate facial recognition AI is. However, Israel is a market leader in this for defense. They have used Palestine as a testbed for this technology for years and years and years and years. There is no more surveilled populace in the entire world than the Palestinians. So for them to not know this stuff, and it's not just the border fence, the AI failed on the border fence. I mean, everything on their phones and all of that, the surveillance against Palestinians is just unprecedented. The fact that they would not know it was happening is absurd, especially when you consider that more or less allied nations, quasi allies, I would sort of put Egypt under its current leadership in that category. They warned Israel that this was going to happen before it happened, and those warnings were ignored. It's very similar to a lot of stuff that happened before 9/11. And of course, for Israeli officials to say this is our 9/11 is pretty significant when you consider that, you know, Israeli intelligence had its own documented role in what happened on 9/11 in the United States. Not saying they were the only ones involved, because obviously U.S. intelligence and you had the Saudis and Pakistani intelligence services involved to degrees. But it, you know, 9/11 was something that was orchestrated for the purpose of justifying war around the world under the guise of combating terrorism. And yes. Israel, at this point in time that October 7th happened, needed some sort of galvanizing event to sort of paper over the divisions that were threatening to split Israeli society and make Netanyahu a less polarizing figure for the purpose of pushing specific policy objectives forward that are longstanding goals, not just of Netanyahu, but the religious right extremist groups with which he is allied in his current government. So the AI explanation, AI failure explanation, reminds me a lot of what CIA officials and military officials said about 9/11 after it happened. It was a failure of imagination. It was just incompetence. Oh, yes, all our systems failed. And routinely, governments like this want you to think they're incompetent so that you don't realize what they're actually doing and what their goals and objectives really are, because you're just, oh, they're so stupid. Let's put another guy in power. Yeah. I mean, you're ultimately, I don't know. I mean, I think it's just part of the deception to write it all off as incompetence, yeah, at the end of the day. And, if there's anything, I know after reporting on it for a very long time on Israeli defense industry, Israeli AI and, you know, defense tech companies, it's that, they know what Palestinians are doing and saying. They tested all there, and the idea that they would not have any sort of forewarning. If Egyptian intelligence could pick it up, Israeli intelligence picked it up.
Yes, I agree.
And there's been a lot of, in recent weeks, even Israeli mainstream media has been forced to acknowledge that the official narratives propagated by Israeli officials in the immediate aftermath of October 7th were erroneous. How many of those civilians were actually killed by the IDF as opposed, yes, to Hamas? And there's been efforts to prevent documentation from coming out from the highest levels of the Israeli military and intelligence communities. That, to me, suggests there's a cover-up. People knew. The insider trading stuff is also pretty damning. And again, I think it comes down, I would ask the same people that are saying, was this incompetence because of over-reliance on AI? How do they feel about 9/11? Was that a failure of imagination to you too? I think these types of events that are so impactful in terms of, the policy solutions that are forced on the populace later when they're, in fear and panicking. Oh, we're being invaded. Oh, look at the incursion Hamas did, and they took hostages. When was the last time this happened? It's been decades. Oh, we can't allow a Palestinian state now, and all of this stuff. I mean, these are things that Netanyahu has always wanted,
Yeah.
And I think people are naive to assume that he wouldn't endanger Israeli lives in pursuit of his policy goals and his ability to stay in power. This is a man who will kill literally anyone to get what he wants. And to think, yeah, that he wouldn't sacrifice Israeli citizens as part of that, I think, is naive, especially when you consider, too, I thought it was interesting as well that apparently one of the events, the music festival that was targeted as part of October 7th, were a bunch of Israelis that were very how should I phrase this? That they were very supportive of peace efforts with the Palestinians. And that is the class of Israelis that Netanyahu and his ilk hate the most.
Yeah.
Wow. How much can she pack into that 10 minutes? Amazing. I think, and just hearing that, I think she's done almost more than we've managed to do ever since October in summing up, the motives of the Israelis to create a LIHOP, Martin. Is it a slam dunk, do you think, or is there still some doubts about whether they were caught by surprise? People like David Miller make a big point of this. Well, actually, this was a great military operation by Hamas.
That's what Scott Ritter's saying as well. I'm inclined to agree with Whitney Webb. Ron Unz has made a point which I think is worth bringing up, which is that Netanyahu and the sort of military establishment actually hate each other. So if the military establishment had done this in order to undermine Netanyahu, then he would have grassed it up. And if Netanyahu had done it to undermine the military establishment, they would have grassed it up. But I think Ron's missing the point there. There's a deep state, yeah, in Israel, which is also, and then where Chossudovsky's coming in is, don't forget the role of the Americans here. The Americans may be involved in this as well. I mean, the American deep state. because they've got their own interests in having wars in the Middle East, which are not necessarily the Israel, you know, their goals coincide with those of the Israeli right wing, but they're not necessarily just the Israeli right wing wagging the
just
dog.
Taking a step back and looking at the politics, of course, we had the accusation by George Galloway saying that Richard Tice messaged him saying, would you join the Reform Party and stand in Rochdale as a Reform candidate? Richard Tice then denied it, but George is saying, hang on, this is on my phone. Do you really want me to publish this, Richard Tice? I won't publish it if you don't say it again. You know, so he's playing a little game, but then there's also this whole business in the States with the right meeting left. In fact, it's happened in places like Ireland too, as well as other countries which escape me right at the moment. And Pakistan, that's why we were talking about this last week, where the traditional left and right parties have actually just become one party for many, many years, of course. We've been saying, well, the post-Corbynite Labour Party is pretty much the same as the Tory Party. They're very similar anyway. And they're now joining together formally as one single party in many cases. Now, we're now seeing in the States this amazing claim by Bobby Kennedy Jr., Robert F. Kennedy, who's a Democrat and he's standing as an independent presidential candidate, that Trump has asked him to be his running mate. So it seems they're sort of falling from a pro-deep state puppet-type candidates into ones that maybe are lying, because they're not.
Yeah, the problem is that the right... And I mean, I think it's interesting that, you know, people like Liz Truss think she's been frustrated by the deep state, and she's actually been frustrated by not being able to tie her own shoelaces. But nevertheless, the fact that yeah. people can talk like this, it means that we can now have a proper yeah. conversation about these things.
The media, 'cause of course, I think the media is really responsible for this in a lot of ways, because it's not putting the criticisms to Truss that really need to be put to her. So it's almost as if she believes in her own propaganda.
Well, I mean, yeah, but I mean, I'm just pointing her out. There are people on the right who see themselves as being frustrated by the deep state, who are in fact being frustrated by reality, because you can't just have unfunded tax cuts and the markets aren't just going to go, that's all right then, you know, because that's not how it works.
I don't want Whitney Webb to totally take me over or this show, but we're going to have another clip from her now, a bit longer, in fact, which is talking about, and we were just hearing about the wars abroad, but what about the home front? What about the war by the deep state on us?
I think it comes down to numbers at the end of the day and risk management on the parts of the elites as to why they lie. And of course, they lie with the expectation that the lie won't be discovered, or at least the discovery of the lie won't be widely disseminated among the public. So it ultimately comes down to control of information, which again, if you control the information people see, you control how they perceive what's going on, i.e. you control how they perceive reality. And like I said earlier, if you can control how people perceive reality, you can control how they behave. And yes. I think that's essentially the ultimate goal of that. So they lie because they know if they were honest about their reasons for things, particularly imperial wars, people would not go for it. You know, like, no, we don't want to sacrifice American lives for oil giants. And no, we don't want to sacrifice, you know, destroy an entire country, one of the most prosperous countries of Africa, and turn it into a place that has open air slave markets and all of this stuff just to prevent Gaddafi from issuing a gold backed Pan-African currency to mm-hmm. protect the petrodollar and all of this.
Yes.
Like, It sort of eliminates the justification the U.S. has relied on ever since the post-World War II era, that it is spreading democracy and freedom and nation building and all of this. And it hasn't been doing that. It hasn't even necessarily in some cases been doing it for the benefit of the U.S. specifically. You can point to several neocon wars, which were really done for the benefit of Israeli foreign policy goals. And actually one of the main purposes of the neoconservative movement in the U.S. is to align U.S. foreign policy goals with Israeli foreign policy goals.
Yes.
So doing, you know, what's best for Israel as opposed to what's best, for the United States. And, you know, a lot of people don't want to do that, especially, you know, in states that have, you know, a large population of Arab Americans, for example, that are not going to be like, well, we don't want that for Israel. It
yes.
seems like a big sacrifice and we gain nothing and they gain everything, things like that. So I mean, they can't be upfront and honest about it, especially with things like the COVID agenda, which was, you know, mass experimentation, eugenics tinged policies, pushing for global digital ID, tighter global governance under like the World Health Organization and things like that. Obviously, if they were open about their agendas, people would not be supportive. They have to be in a state of fear and panic. That's frequently accompanies these lies, because without the fear and panic, people are more likely to engage in critical thought and take their time to analyze the arguments. And if they're in a state of fear and panic, they will not, and are more likely to acquiesce to the policy solutions that are rolled out in front of them. So, you know, I think, you know, it's the lie, but it also is integrated with, keeping people in particular emotional states that make them more susceptible to suggestion and to solutions they otherwise would not accept. And I mean, I think a lot of what you laid out is essentially built around that. And that could not operate without the success of the legacy media. And unfortunately, a significant number of influential figures and independent media have essentially promoted a lot of the same tactics, I guess, that ultimately do the public a disservice in terms of generating extreme fear and panic, being extremely partisan, maybe in a different way than mainstream media is being. But it ultimately serves what a lot of people refer to as the left-right paradigm, where you have one of the hands, either the left or right, creating some sort of debacle. And then the other hand comes in and offers a solution to the problem created by the other hand intentionally. You know, and then you get a policy that people would never have wanted in the first place, but it's perceived as coming from different actors when it's really the same entity.
Whitney, there is nothing funny about manipulating people and fooling them over and over again, but there is one funny element in it, and that is, for example, the CIA has lots of declassified documents and classified documents, and then in a decade or two or three, they declassify it and they publish it to the public. And we can see that what they have done 30, 40, 50 years ago in a certain geography, for example, in Latin America or in the Middle East, it was complete hoax. It was based on a hoax. And they repeat the same lines over and over again today in 2024, well knowing that we know that they're lying, and they know that we know that they're lying, but they're still lying about these cases, right? In 2024. Yeah. And people are still falling for it over and over again. This is something that, it's not little bit, it bothers me a lot, because, I like to wake, people also up and, about different cases. And one of which was during what happened in COVID times. And of all the major events that happened in the past three decades, personally, I think that the corona era was the peak of what manipulation and hysteria and fear-mongering may look like. And to the extent that critical experts, for example, called it mass psychosis of the people. Shall we expect worst in the coming years? I know this is a pessimistic question, or is that already is that already the limit of what the people can accept from the governments?
I don't think COVID was the limit. I think for them, it was for them to go farther than they've ever gone before. And, you know, based on what they learned about how people reacted to what they tried to do during the COVID era, that can allow them to, you know, adjust certain factors and variables for future experiments in mass hysteria. So, you know, in the U.S. specifically, in independent media, there were people that drew parallels between COVID era hysteria and post 9/11 hysteria in the U.S. And I think that's definitely fair. But consider that, you know, post 9/11 hysteria was concentrated in the United States of America, whereas the COVID hysteria was throughout the world. So it was replicating that same type of hysteria, in the 9/11 era, it wasn't just terrorism hysteria. It was also biosecurity hysteria because of the intimately related anthrax attacks. So you had sort of the agenda for biosecurity in there as well, but within the United States. And this was an effort to see, in my opinion, see if they could replicate the hysteria at the global level, which they pretty successfully did. The question is, will the same people that realized they were had during COVID, but were compliant at first. How compliant will they be in future crises going forward? And so what I anticipate is that there's going to be a series, instead of having one big event, they're likely to do a series of cascading crises that do things like drastically impact supply chains, drastically alter essential digital infrastructure, specifically banking and financial systems, under the guise of cyber attacks and all of this. So during the COVID era, there was, I guess you could call it foreshadowing of groups like the World Economic Forum saying, you know, after COVID, there will be a cyber pandemic, the consequences of which will, you know, make COVID look like nothing, essentially. Paraphrasing yes. there, but that's essentially what was stated. And now the World Economic Forum has said, well, they said in the beginning of 2023 that there will be some sort of massive cyber event that will make COVID look like nothing. And it will happen before January 2025, which now that we're in 2024, if they are correct, would be sometime this year. Yeah. And if you follow any of the sort of cyber attack narratives that are propagated in U.S. mainstream media or Western mainstream media more broadly, all the cyber attackers are blamed on, you know, U.S. empire adversary states, North Korea, Iran, China, and Russia, right? All the hackers are from there. But what they don't tell you is essentially all of the companies attributing blame for these hacks to nation states are either funded directly by the CIA through NQTEL, or they're composed almost entirely of former Unit 8200 people, which is Israel's signal intelligence unit.
Wow.
So these are essentially front companies for intelligence saying this nation state is to blame and they are attacking us. So the next 9/11 is set to be a cyber 9/11 that has global implications.
Wow.
To sort of push us into some greater war. And it's likely that whatever the next one to drop, at least the United States, is likely to be blamed on Iran just because of the extreme integration of Israeli intelligence front companies involved in cybersecurity, how integrated they are both at the U.S. government and military level in terms of digital infrastructure and also in the corporate world. Very extensive and very significant. And Israeli intelligence for the past 20 plus years has been very open about having specific programs that have essentially unlimited funding to goad the U.S. into attacking Iran first so that Israel doesn't have to launch the first strike on Iran. When it comes to the point where Israeli leadership decides that Iran needs to be engaged in a direct hot war. And Netanyahu is on record saying things like America is easily moved, i.e. he knows yes. how to manipulate the states. For those purposes, and you have sort of the return of the neocons through Trump, who ironically campaigned previously as being anti-neocon back in 2015 and 2016. But he's obviously very firmly ensconced in the foreign policy goals like of the neocons, which is, you know, ultimately directed by, you know, Israeli foreign policy goals, as I said earlier. So Netanyahu and if Trump comes back to power, as even the World Economic Forum is suggesting is what will happen, then you will have a return to, you know, the same foreign policy team that brought you the assassination of Qasem Soleimani, that tried to do coups in Venezuela. The whole idea that Trump was this anti-war president is frankly absurd. He didn't start any new wars. He continued the same ones, and they attempted to start new wars, but did not do so successfully.
Yes.
His national security advisor for a good part of his administration was John Bolton, the most notorious like Iran war hawk of all. So to think that this wouldn't happen under Trump is, you know, you're living in la la land. You know, his foreign policy goals are dominated by Israel, and it's the same as the neocons at the end of the day. So if there is some sort of cyber attack blamed on Iran, which again is being, the blame is being laid by these intelligence front companies, you know, it's that gives them the pretext for war. And the problem with this is cyber attacks, you don't even necessarily have to blame the nation state or have evidence. You can say any group you want faceless hackers. You don't see them, right? You can blame literally any group you want and then sort of follow the same model they followed with 9/11, be like, oh, Al-Qaeda is responsible. Al-Qaeda is backed by Iraq and have no evidence of Iraq backing them and then invade Iraq. You know,
yeah, they could even have agents in this country, like in Russia, for example, and they wage, let's say, limited cyber attacks against their own country from Russia. And they say the location of the attack is coming from Russia. Therefore, they're backed by Russia.
Yeah, sure. Absolutely. They do stuff like that all the time. And we know from one of WikiLeaks's last releases, known as Vault 7, the CIA has the ability to place fingerprints of every nation state, including its adversaries, in hacks the CIA actually conducts. Mm. And part of the Vault 7 release was saying that the CIA lost control of these tools, so they're everywhere. So presumably every intelligence agency can do that. So there's really no way to know who actually conducted a cyber attack. And the bar for blaming these nation states is extremely low. Some of these, cybersecurity or, cyber, analysis companies or whatever, they'll say things like medium to high probability that it was this group, that we think is tied to Iran because the leader of it, previously worked or his believed work history, was for some Iranian state company, and believed work history isn't even confirmed or documented or known work history. And then they're like, the headline will read Iran conducts cyber attack or hacks this thing. It was actually said during the Trump, reelection effort in 2020 that, Iran had hacked his campaign and all of this stuff. And Microsoft, which has a significant amount of overlap with Israeli intelligence and American intelligence, it was the company laying the blame there, again, with very limited evidence. So do we really want to trust these people about us, you know, leading us into war? Again, if you take down people's essential internet infrastructure when we've been made so dependent on it and it disrupt people's daily life, it's easy to create fear and panic in the same way COVID hysteria did, because people don't know what's happening. Their daily lives have been greatly impacted, and where will they turn for news?
So that's Whitney Webb. Second clip from her this week, and I'll put a link obviously up on our show page at thisweek.org.uk to the full Syriana analysis interview with Whitney there. Martin, what she's showing there, I think, is the use of conjunction of fear and panic with in that case a cyber attack, but this is quite clearly this kind of Naomi Klein shock doctrine, which is now completely hardwired in on October the 7th with the Hamas attacks on Israel and the Israeli what they say is a proportionate response, which clearly isn't. So anyway, what do you make of Whitney's take there on the next pandemic being a kind of cyber wave, a cyber attack?
Well, it's worth definitely considering, and she's a very knowledgeable person, and it makes a lot of sense, because what they generally tend to do is flag these things up in advance so that you give people the idea, you know, something terrible might happen, there might be a cyber attack. And of course, that's pretty clear evidence that they are going to carry out such a cyber attack. I think what's missing from her analysis, and it's not
the same happened with COVID, by the way, didn't it? With Fauci giving an announcement a year or 18 months beforehand, saying there's going to be people were like, well, what do you mean there's going to be a pandemic? What are you talking about? How do you know?
Yeah, well, obviously, you know, we've debated COVID quite a lot on this show, and my view is it was a deliberately designed bioweapon by the people we're talking about. And then the responses by different governments around the world were to an act of war, effectively. And that was what it was. I mean, World War III has long ago started. Everybody who died in COVID was a war victim.
I'm in the middle at the moment of Kees van der Peel's States of Emergency, which is absolutely forensic in going through all this. He wrote it, I think, in late 2020 during the COVID pandemic, and he's writing about all these things. He's saying, well, look, it's not good enough for the deep state to create these massive wars, you know, the kind of national hate day against Putin, this sort of thing, but they've also got to absolutely control and destroy any genuine kind of civil society organization, things like trade unions, churches, these sorts of things that might be campaigning against what they're doing and protesting against them. They want to control those too.
They do, but I think she's, we know, you know, when we're talking about this, we're arming ourselves to resist. It doesn't always work out how they intended. So although it was a let it happen on purpose on October the 7th, there are still tens of thousands of Hamas fighters inside Gaza, in the tunnels, and they are killing Israeli soldiers every day, as they should. And of course, and the question about whether the state of Israel should exist at all comes onto the agenda.
Yeah, I think your point that you make quite regularly on here is very important, this idea that many of these so-called hostages are actually POWs, aren't they?
They are. And that, so when they talk about release of the hostages, you know, I don't think there's going to be any hostage exchange. It's quite clear that the Israeli government doesn't give a stuff about the hostages. They killed loads of them on October the 7th itself. This is becoming increasingly clear.
Yesterday, Thursday, a massacre, about 120 people who were just trying to pick up food at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning from an aid convoy were massacred. And this is the latest figures I've seen is 400 injured. So this is quite clearly a message by the Israelis that we don't really want to have any negotiations. We don't want peace.
That's right. And of course, but the thing is, World War III is going to be World War III. The deep state in the West has done all of these evil things, and people like Whitney and people like ourselves, but using Whitney's research, we can work out what's going on. You can bet your bottom dollar that the FSB know what's going on, as do the Chinese and the Iranians, and they share intelligence as well. Now, they don't shout from the rooftops, we know exactly what happened there, because you don't if you've got an army and other ways to hit back. Well, it's not a question of just exposing things. It's like, we know what you did there, and we're going to pay you back in our own good time. Well, and that's what she's missing.
The competition for the control of the British political system is raging away, with George Galloway managing to make it into Parliament today. In the early hours, I think it was 2 o'clock this morning, from the Workers' Party. And we'll be hearing, as I said, from Steve Hall, who's from the Workers' Party, who's written a book called The Death of the Left. See what he makes of this. Quite nice timing that we've got this Galloway victory today. But Martin, on the other side of things, the new Labour MP, your Labour MP, your party, is married to a former Israeli spy recruiter. This is the new MP, a couple of weeks ago, elected for the Kingswood ward in Gloucestershire, just in the north of Bristol. Former Israeli soldier, Yussi Felberbaum, and his husband, Damien Egan. Well, Damien Egan is the new MP, but this guy is known to be a recruiter for Unit 8200. Now, in a way, this Unit 8200 links exactly back to what Whitney Webb was just saying there about cyber war, because that's exactly what they do, surveillance and cyber war. In fact, Unit 8200 is known to have been doing surveillance and targeting, bribery they do quite a lot of. So they'll go in, they'll find someone that they think knows something because they've been looking at their phone or eavesdropping on them. And they also do assassinations, murders too. So this is the guy of Palestinians, you know, and of the opponents of Israel, and of the opponents of Israel's friends as well, because these intelligence services do go into different people's sites. For example, lots of rumours that David Kelly, the British scientist, was killed by a Mossad squad because he was opposing the pro-Israel lobby in Britain's plans for the war on Iraq, which was part of an Israeli foreign policy. So Unit 8200, just to say that they're doing blackmail, targeting people, they're murdering, this sort of thing. It's not, this guy, why have we got an MP who's married, a man who's married to another man that's fulfilled this role for the Israeli intelligence services?
Well, I mean, I'm not familiar with exactly the path to power or election that Damien Egan has made. Obviously, Marvin wanted to put his hat into that ring, but the local party didn't want it.
Yossi Felderbaum, who's this guy's Matthew Egan, sorry, what's his name
Daniel.
Again? Daniel Egan's husband, if you can call him husband. I think he's probably partner, really, looking at the guy, these two. That he's now working for Google. So he was working for Unit 8200, now working for Google.
Well, he's obviously in that world. And don't forget that other Labour MPs here, Fangham, Debonair, Karen Smith, and Dan... what's his name? Up in the northwest, Darren Jones. Right. They are all Labour friends of Israel. Okay? None of them are members of the Palestine Solidarity Campaign. All three of them are Labour friends of Israel. I understand that Kerry McCarthy is not a Labour friend of Israel, but she's not in the Palestine Solidarity Campaign either. Of course, somebody who is in the Palestine Solidarity Campaign and well known is Jeremy Corbyn, who used to be the leader of the party. I think it's quite interesting. In the past, it was considered, you know, you can be a Labour friend of Israel, but you can also be a Palestine Solidarity Campaign supporter. Why not? We're a broad church.
6 years. But not now. This 6 years that Felderbaum spent in the Israeli military, which is longer than you need to do for national service, so he was rather keen on this whole idea of spying on people and blackmailing and murdering them.
Well, yes. So he's definitely one of them. And I think Dan, I mean, in Bristol West, which was now becoming Bristol Central, that if that became known to the electorate in that constituency, they wouldn't win. But of course, Kingswood is a bit different. Yeah. So, you know, he's basically the choice of the party apparatchik. And of course, that's who he is.
He's doing tours around the country talking about anti-Semitism.
Well, there you are. So, in other words, he's very much reliable from, you know, Starmer, don't forget, he's married to a Jewish woman, and the whole, you know, so-called definition of anti-Semitism, which means attacking Israel, is anti-Semitic, which, of course, has been challenged in the courts here in Bristol and knocked down by David Miller. I think this is all coming to a head. Because in actual fact, these people are apologists for Israel. As we said earlier, this war isn't going to end. The election poll, which happens in this country this year, the dominant issue is going to be genocide in Palestine. And these people are going to have to answer a few questions in an election campaign. They're not going to be able to hide in a corner. And that's going to have a serious impact on the outcome of the election.
What about the World Economic Forum talking about this cyber event before January 2025?
Well, it may well be that they're going for an all-out, we're going to have a war with Russia and China. But the problem with that is, if you read anything serious, as I do, is they can't win. They can't even win a war with Iran. They can't win a war with Yemen. They're losing.
So what's happened in Ukraine? They could never win a war with Russia, but what's happened is the fruit of the whole of the youth of Ukraine has been destroyed by the Ukrainian Zelensky and largely by the people propping him up in NATO.
That's right. But I mean, the whole idea of trying to create an enemy so that you can consolidate your power within your own little empire, or big empire as it is that you've got to be able to win against the enemies you've created.
Tens of
if
thousands.
They beat you, then that's going to be a bit
but
difficult.
But what's happened
isn't it?
Is that tens of thousands of Ukrainians have been forced into the meat grinder.
Well, they
I mean,
have,
might they be trying to do the same with the people who live in the NATO countries, you know, between the ages of around about 20 and 50 or so?
Yes, I mean, the idea is, I mean, the head of the British Armed Forces, Admiral Tony Radkin, was saying that Putin would never attack NATO because NATO would win very quickly and therefore Russia would be destroyed. So he's never going to do that. The reason Putin isn't going to attack NATO is because he's rational. There's no point in starting a war with NATO, which could end in a nuclear war. And that's what he said this week when Macron was saying he's going to send French troops to Ukraine. He said, if you do that, you're a nuclear power. We could end up with a nuclear exchange. Are you mad? And of course, in actual fact, what they are doing is that NATO, as Scott Ritter and Doug McGregor, who are both ex-NATO officers, are pointing out, NATO is a busted flush. And the Israelis need to think about that, because the Russian aerospace forces and others, special forces, are based in Syria, just over the border from them. And in actual fact, if you look at the geography of Israel, it's a country the size of Wales. And ultimately, in World War III, little countries like that, even with big armies, their air force could be knocked out. Just knocked out. And then what? You've got no air cover. Can you fight without air cover? No, you can't.
Before the end of the first hour, it's always nice to get in a bit of local news if we can. Nice to see our Mayor Marvin Rees up at the London School of Economics speaking there. What is the London School of Economics, the LSE? It's quite a place that the intelligence services like to hang out.
Well, it was founded in the early part of the 20th century. I actually applied to go there, but I went to Oxford in the end. It was founded by Fabian socialists to study economics, not necessarily from a pro-capitalist point of view. So that was also where Mick Jagger went. And so in the 60s, it had a reputation of being one of those universities where lefty people were in the faculty and also in the student union and so on. So that's what attracted me to it. But of course, because it's well connected, they've got plenty of connections with the establishment in the mainstream of the economics.
Although he doesn't like doing interviews with journalists here. In fact, he likes to shut the local democracy reporters out of his news conferences because they ask him awkward questions about climate change and jetting over to Vancouver to do 20-minute talks, TED talks, and saying, well, this is a little bit hypocritical of you, Marvin, is it not? And then, of course, the journalists get banned. But he does like doing talks in front of what he perceives to be a credulous, friendly, distant audience here at the London School of Economics. And if you listen closely, you'll hear also he's giving us a clue about what he thinks his job is going to be. I mean, he was tapped up to be mayor. He was tapped up, sent to Harvard and Yale, particularly Yale. He met Alexei Navalny as a Yale World Fellow. So somebody somewhere decided at a young age that he was going to be a future leader. Don't know how he manages to do this, but they keep putting him in jobs. Maybe it's like a kind of corporate headhunter system. You know, these corporate headhunters like Odgers have a whole list of people that they think are pliable and will do as they're told. And they're the ones that get the top jobs. If you applied to be a non-executive director of a company and didn't get in, that's probably because you're not on Odgers' special list, and go and butter them up and maybe bribe them, and you might provide yourself with a nice cushy directorship. But anyway, he gives us also a hint here, Martin, of what his job is going to be when he leaves and stops being mayor in May.
Do I think city leaders should be dictators? Well, that's one of the arguments made around the mayoralty in Bristol, which is why Bristol had a referendum and decided to go for a committee system. The argument being that a city can't be run by one person with all the power who's unaccountable. Silly arguments, you know.
So, Marvin, thank you. We're nearly out of time. It wouldn't be right if I didn't ask Marvin the question, the TikTok question, which is, Marvin, what next?
Lots of things, I think. So I finish as mayor in May, 8 years. It'll be an interesting time. You know, we're now just on the trying to land well. A whole bunch of things. I've got a book in August. I've actually put my hat in the ring for UN Habitat, next exec director of UN Habitat. We'll see what goes on there. I'm told lots of politics involved, but hey, you know, put yourself forward to see what happens. and obviously I've come and visited here as well. There's a great work going on training city leaders here, doing some work with University of Bristol. I'm really keen to stay in the space of understanding what cities are, thinking about what we need them to be, and then thinking how we get them there, both in terms of the policy support, the policy space, the global structure around them, and what leadership is needed to help cities become the fullness of what they can be for all of our goods, not just for their own good, but because I think if we get cities right, the world will be in a much better place. If we get cities wrong, they're going to be a global liability.
Well, yeah, and many would say, Martin, the reason you have been voted out and the whole system that put you there has also been voted out is because you've got it wrong.
Well, he's obviously not going to agree with that because he thinks he got it right.
What do you think?
I think when he says there, a committee system, you know, you can't have democracy with an elected mayor, he's got a vested interest. He was an elected mayor, so therefore, he's unlikely to be against elected mayors. Unlike, you know, I mean, Ken Livingstone remained against elected mayors. I presume he's still against them because when he's doing the stuff at the GLC back in the day, he wasn't an elected mayor. He was the leader of the Labour group. So he was answerable to the Labour group. And that's, he said, well, that's the system I believe in. And that, in fact, is the system which has worked best. You know, the GLC was the most innovative of local government. You know, they really pioneered a lot of stuff.
Isn't
in that
it amazing?
Era.
I mean,
we didn't do it with an elected mayor.
We get things like these failed politicians like Chris Patten, who got booted out as an MP, Neil Kinnock, who got booted out as Labour leader. They suddenly get these marvellous jobs as European Union commissioners, that sort of thing. Well, look, the same sort of thing looks like it may be happening with Marvin. Do you know anything about this organisation, UN Habitat, that he wants to, he thinks he may be taking over?
I don't know a lot about it, but I mean, it's a UN organisation that looks at cities and housing. So you can see, he sees himself as one of these people that you know, understands cities.
Environmentally sustainable towns and cities. Yeah. So, UN Habitat is the focal point for all urbanisation and human settlement matters within the UN system. works with partners to build inclusive, safe, resilient and sustainable cities and communities. UN Habitat promotes urbanization as a positive transformative force for people and communities, reducing inequality, discrimination and poverty. Sounds like the sort of megacity boss of the whole world.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's not surprising that he's, as a professional person, he's going to try and leverage his skills and experience into a job like that. It wouldn't surprise me at all. And he might, I mean, you know, as he said, there's a lot of politics involved and it's extremely competitive.
And he's made an absolute mess of Bristol, with particularly with the idea of getting rid of all the planning controls and just turning over the decision-making process about planning over to the big developers. I mean, that is actually a complete failure to look after the city, which he doesn't seem to have recognised.
Well, Andy Burnham has done pretty much the same thing in Manchester. I don't know if you've seen the documentaries about the mess in Manchester of the developers have made of it, but that's because the mayor doesn't actually control the developers.
But what's happening is these people
it's
are...
It's a fantasy.
It isn't a fantasy, no. Here, what's been happening is various people who are employed by the council, who the mayor does control, if they've been standing in the way, they've been being gotten rid of. So the mayor most definitely has had a role in that. It's like he's being rewarded by being put in charge of this massive global...
Well, he's not got the job yet. He's just put his...
Well, we shall see. He seems to think he's got a good chance.
I think the problem is, when the Greens take over in a committee system this May, they are going to have the developers pushing them to do things, and they will probably have to do the same, pretty much. Because in actual fact, local government doesn't have any real powers. It's a fantasy, certainly in this country, and that's the problem. So we talk about the, you know, city leadership, and what can they actually do? Nothing. Can they do anything about universal credit and the rules around universal credit, which are absolutely crucial for all sorts
of
people?
Well, the trouble is,
you can't do anything about
Marvin Rees, he doesn't seem to want to do anything about it. And he's not even making speeches pushing back against these massive Tory cuts. He occasionally mentions it, but to him, it's just... I mean, actually, George Ferguson, the previous mayor, had a much better attitude, which was, look, let's just duck and dive and try and save the most important services. What Marvin's done, as soon as he came in, there was a massive campaign against his cuts. He decided he was going to be the hatchet man. In fact, there was a cartoon with a hatchet in his head,
yes,
wasn't there, in the Bristolian,
yes,
saying the best cut of all. So he actually relished this idea of going in and cutting, whereas the previous mayor decided, George Ferguson had decided, let's try and, you know, just make sure that the most essential services are kept going. We've had a constant battle by the people with learning difficulties, as you work in the school system, to actually get for people to actually get their legal right to an education under this council, because the mayor has been cutting it whilst spending, I was going to use a wasting money, massive amounts of money on things like Bristol Energy and the Colston Hall, etc. There's all sorts of things which have been propped up by the mayor, which have just wasted. I think the total is something like £80 million, which could have been spent on other things, maybe even up to £100 million. So this is where what he's been doing. He's been throwing good money after bad, so like Hinkley Point type attitude. Anyway, so I'm not expecting Marvin to support the idea of getting rid of mayors, but I'm just rather disgusted by this idea that he's going to go on to amass some sort of super career in the UN, doing even more damage.
Well, he's not necessarily going to get the job, Tony. And I'll point out, did you go to the demonstration that he called against cuts when he was first elected? I went there with lots of trade unionists. Were you on that demonstration? I don't remember seeing your face.
Then he brought in loads of cuts,
didn't
he?
Yes, because...
And now all those demonstrators, Martin, all those demonstrators you've been standing with turned against him almost straight away.
Well, there's an issue there, I'm sure. But what he could have done is done what Liverpool Council did in the 1980s and refused to set a council tax rate.
I suppose one could say that at least Bristol isn't one of those cities that's about to go bankrupt somehow.
Yes, that's because we've got lots of capital. Bristol's a relatively wealthy city, although there's lots of poor people in it. What Ferguson did was sell off the port, so he got the capital gain from that, so he could then pursue his own re-election campaign. What he was doing was, and the problem with the mayoral system, while the local government is being deprived of basic funding for things like special needs, is that they have to come up with wizard wheezes to get themselves re-elected, rather than getting on with doing the job of managing the city. And that's because the basic fundamental power in Britain does not lie at this level. We are a centralised state, where the central government...
That doesn't seem to have dawned on Marvin. He seems to think he's mega powerful.
I think the problem with Marvin is he bought into the Ferguson fantasy that mayors are important and I'm an important person. What he should have done is, in my view, and I've said this before on this show, he should have turned around to people and said, the truth is, I can't do anything very much. We're not going to be able to achieve anything at all until we've got this wretched government out. And there's nothing much as a mayor that I can do. Sorry. And we would have understood. But he bought into this whole idea that mayors make a difference. When the budget's been cut by 60%, you're not going to make a difference, are you? What you've got to do is overturn the central government that's making that decision. And you are just a member of the Labour Party helping us overturn that central government. The fantasy in this city, in any city, is that we've got control of what goes on here. We haven't. We just don't have control. Local people don't have control of it. The local council don't have control of it. The developers have control of it, and they're the funders of the Conservative Party, which controls most things in this country one way or another. They are the party of power.
Are they?
They certainly
well, they
are.
Won't be, they won't be this year, will they?
No, they won't.
Team B will be taking over, almost
that's
certainly.
Right.
Won't they?
Well, it looks like it. Looks
will
like
it make any difference if Starmer wins?
Well, it will make a difference because we won't have anybody doing another 50 days of Liz Truss. They won't do anything stupid like that, but they're not going to do anything positive because they've already, Rachel Reeves has basically said, we're not going to have any money, so we can't do anything, which is a fantasy because we're going to have a global crisis and they'll have to spend money, just like in the pandemic, because there's nothing else to do.
Do you think that, to a certain extent, Reeves and Starmer are saying the right thing to the big business at the WEF, et cetera, to try and get power, and then they might do something more radical?
Well, people are suggesting that might be the case, but I don't believe that for a minute. They're basically... They're too small as people to play that kind of game. That I think Rachel Reeves really does believe that she's got to keep the that there is no magic money tree and all the rest of it. When it's absolutely obvious that there is a flipping magic money tree. There are loads of magic money trees. But of course that would freak out the powers that be in the deep state. Rachel Reeves and Starmer, for example, could just be pointing out to the electorate the big problem and why we've got a cost of living crisis is because our allies, the United States of America, blew up the Nord Stream 2 pipeline, which has essentially destroyed the European economy. That's what it's done. The European economy is now about to go into not a recession, a depression. And there's going to be hell to pay. Meanwhile, of course, Russia is chugging along and the United States is sucking in all of this resources from all over the world. They're going to cannibalise the European economy. Loads of big companies in Europe are now moving to the United States.
We've had a vote on the budget now and Bristol residents are going to face a 5% rise in council tax. So that is obviously not helping with the cost of living crisis at all. Labour Mayor Marvin Rees has done a deal with guess who?
I don't know.
The city's Conservative group.
Yes.
Which has seen the proposal approved by 33 votes to 18. The Greens voted against the plan, describing it as an austerity budget. It comes after a week after the council failed to approve a deal in the first time of asking, after councillors voted against the plans during a meeting which lasted 3 hours. So this is Bristol City Council finally approving its budget, which at least I suppose he's keeping he's balancing the books, isn't he? Now, look, let's just
well,
have a little...
Well, not quite. I mean, they haven't balanced it, but they're within the limits that you don't get special measures like Liverpool and Birmingham.
We're going to hear from Steve Hall in a moment. First, let's hear from Klaus Schwab from the World Economic Forum.
When I was speaking here 7 years ago, after having written a book about the Fourth Industrial Revolution, I showed how this revolution will change how we live, how we act, how we communicate, how we produce, and how we consume. Now, we are speaking not just about the Fourth Industrial Revolution. We are speaking about the transition of humankind into a new era, which is not just characterized by technological change. A new era where humankind will enjoy many more opportunities and possibilities. It's a transition. It's a transition from we first had the transition about 100 years ago from the agricultural society to the industrial society. But today, we speak about the transition into what I would call the intelligent age. And I did something maybe unusual. I took ChatGPT And I had a long discussion with ChatGPT, with my pot, if I may say so, to see how this new era will look like. And finally, I had about 20 pages of text, and I asked ChatGPT, summarize the text and tell me now, based on our discussion, how will the new era, the intelligent era, look like? And I read you the text. Envisioning a future propelled by the technologies of the fourth industrial revolution, we see a new dawn of human civilization, one that harmonizes technology with the deepest needs and aspirations of humanity. This vision unfolds within a society where artificial intelligence, robotics, the Internet of the Things, 3D printing, genetic engineering, quantum computing become the foundations of our daily life.
Well, thanks very much to Klaus Schwab. Martin, what do you make of Mr. Schwab? He's just sort of talking these very kind of gobbledygook terms about this amazing transformation. And you seem to be agreeing with him when he said the Industrial Revolution happened about 100 years ago.
Well, I mean, he's using a mental shorthand there, isn't he, saying that? In actual fact, industrialization happened at different times in different countries. So it didn't all happen at once 100 years ago, did it? I mean, the main thing you've got to say about it is how, vague it is. It's just that, trust us, we've got the technology. There's nothing there about conflict, about power, about politics. It's all airbrushed out. So what we're really talking about is that, these people that attend the World Economic Forum, the Davos elite, etc., they want us to believe that they have our best interests at heart, and all we've got to do is go along with their plans. And of course, there's an awful lot of people who don't believe that that's the case. The World Economic Forum is, it's not even a place where the real decisions are made. It's a place where they gather these people together to tell them what's going to happen. And Schwab is a functionary. He's not, the real power brokers aren't people like him.
It seems to me that this is where most of the left is going. And let's see if, I hope I'm joined on the line by Steve Hall. Steve, can you hear me?
I can hear you, Tony.
Steve, you're, it's quite actually rather serendipitous having you on, because you're a member of the Workers' Party, are you not?
I certainly am, yeah. And I'm feeling quite good today,
you
as
are,
you can imagine.
Aren't you? Do you want to just take us through what you make of George's victory in Rochdale, George Galloway?
Well, it's a small crack in the neoliberal dam. Let's not get too excited right now. But it does show that there's resistance against this two-party duopoly, which are two cheeks of the same backside, the same global neoliberal backside that has been in power all over the Western world and has been causing trouble on the borders with the East since the late 1970s. And it shows that people in this country, certainly in the, I don't like to call them derelict areas because that's an insult to the people who live there, but they're certainly the old industrial zones that have been experiencing great problems since deindustrialization in the 1980s, that they've had enough of the whole thing. Brexit was one example. I think that was a protest vote. I don't think there was an awful lot of economic, political knowledge went into that vote. It's a protest because we've been in Europe for a long time since Jacques Delors threw all that stuff at us in the 1990s. We've been in for a long time. We've been associated with Europe since the late 1940s and one way. And it didn't really do anything. It didn't help us at all. We didn't deindustrialize.
Well, most people would say, Steve, most people would say the opposite, wouldn't they? I mean, it's been
absolutely
a period of deindustrialization completely.
Well, it has.
I mean, Bristol, for example, we were making more aircraft here than anywhere in the world at the beginning, or just at the end of the Second World War, being manufactured here and flying off to do their dirty deeds wherever. But now there's absolutely nothing, not in the whole country.
Nothing. And up north here in Sunderland, we made these famous cargo ships selling all over the world. We had the huge Swan Hunters, once made the largest ships in the world. We had heavy industry all over the place. And if you look at the Maastricht Treaty, the rules that Europe threw at us was, you know, this sort of competition laws, fiscal responsibility. You can only spend 3% of GDP, which is ridiculous, when you consider how much we invested in our country after the 1945. Between 1945 and 1960, you had the highest growth since the early 19th century. So Europe was a weight on our shoulders, and throwing it off was an opportunity. Of course, with Tories in power, we missed that opportunity because we went straight out of the frying pan of Europe into the fire of the global investors who now control which regions rise or fall. You know, these, you know, private equity corporations with the huge institutional funds, pension funds, insurance funds, and they're leveraging a lot of money in as well, making their own bets. They don't tell you how much. I'd like to know. And we're under their cosh all the time. So we have no, I think that what we could call a democratic deficit and a sovereign deficit in this country, we're basically not in charge of our own country.
That's one of the reasons that was people voted for Brexit, probably one of the main reasons, that and immigration.
Yeah.
Now, look, you've come up with this book, The Death of the Left, and in a way, it's a terrible thing to be discussing your book on the day when George Galloway comes back to the Houses of Parliament. Can you just tell us a bit about yourself and some of your background that you decided to write this?
Yeah, well, I was brought up in the old steel town of Concert in County Durham. And after Margaret Thatcher's victory in 1979, soon after she abandoned capital controls and capital exchange controls and allow money to flow out of the country. Of course, capital controls are one of the fundamental planks of the Keynesian economics that had kept this country sort of on the rails since 1945. They closed the steelworks, putting 10,000 out of work overnight, steelworks plus ancillary industries. So I got the sharp end of deindustrialization as a young man, watching it happen. It was quite incredible. The steelworks were covered 4.5 square miles. It was the largest steelworks in Europe. It was had been a way of life there since the 1840s, since the iron foundry was set up in 1840. And being on the sharp end of that made me realize that there are people in charge of the global economy who don't really care about working people. They don't care about us at all. So I was a musician at the time. I was involved in the miners' strike, of course, because of the closing the mining industry as well. Some of the mines were exhausted for an awful lot longer. They should have been. And I saw the sharp end of deindustrialization. I saw the weakness of politicians when Ben failed to get in, and we ended up with Kinnock, and of course Blair. And after the Thatcherites had been ousted, and I just felt totally powerless and unrepresented. So I decided to leave the music industry and became an academic. I worked in the Northeast all my life, family up here. I didn't want to travel, so I worked at the University of Durham and Teesside and Northumbria. Eventually, I ended up working in the criminology department, but really my background is in sociology and economic history. Don't ask me why a job came up. I took it. I ended up in the criminology department writing about the relationship between economic change and levels of crime and changes in the criminal justice system. I suppose that politicized me, seeing deindustrialization, seeing the ways of life completely thrown in the dustbin over the 80s and 90s. And I became sort of highly political animal at the time, and I wanted to see serious change. I must admit, I voted for Tony Blair. I have to make that confession. It's cathartic making that confession.
Yeah, I bet you probably had a glass of champagne that night, didn't you, I bet?
Well, not champagne up here, Tony. You know,
a pint of mild.
Not even mine. That's a Midlands thing.
Oh,
you know,
we Newquay Brown. Yes,
no? Absolutely no. I had a pint of something. I can't remember what it was. I think it was Duke's Ale, and had a few actually. And I thought that was a great thing, but of course Blair was a huge letdown. We realised that Blair was a devout neoliberal, and we got years of Margaret Thatcher Mark II.
Yeah, we did. Well, anyway, look, on your book, your chapter two is about democracies entitled Democracy Without the People, the Rise and Fall of Left Populism. Now, this populism term is something I find a bit irritating because, of course, the idea is that we want leaders to be popular. Actually, over in Russia, their president is popular. A lot of people think he's great and vote for him and this sort of thing. Whereas over here, the attitude seems to be, number one, a lot of people don't want to vote, as we saw in Rochdale, and as we'll no doubt see in the general election. One of the reasons people do come out and vote in this country is to try and stop the worst of the two or whatever candidates getting in. So what do you mean about the rise and fall of left populism?
Well, we don't mean populism. We're not using the word as a pejorative at all. In fact, later on in the book, we talk about the history of populism in the West, particularly William Jennings Bryan's Populist Party of America.
You say we. Did you write this with someone else?
Simon Winlow and I, yeah.
Okay. Do you want to tell us a little bit about him?
Oh, him? Yes. Oh, well, he's a Macam. He's a Sunderland lad, so we follow rival football teams, but we're best of mates. Simon's another professor of criminology. He's a bit younger than me, still working. I'm retired. Unfortunately, he still has to work for a living. And we're very, very similar backgrounds. He's from Sunderland, just along the road. He saw the huge Austin Pickersgill shipyards and the glass factories and all the rest of their industry closed. They got a little bit back with Nissan, of course, but that's another matter. And he has we both have very similar backgrounds. That's where we're
okay. Tell us about this left populism? What do you mean?
Well, populism was a bona fide political position throughout the 19th century. If you look at, for instance, Henry Hyman's Social Democratic Federation in this country, William Jennings Bryan, Populist Party in America, they were sort of democratic socialist stroke social democratic parties. And populism didn't have this bad name. So it was given a bad name by neoliberals. And the problem is that we regard neoliberals as this modern, something, a political movement that came on the scene and just appeared out of nowhere in 1979. If we look at the history of neoliberalism, we can trace it back to the decline of the Habsburg Empire in the early 1920s. It's a project. They put themselves across as, an organic development of markets, some sort of natural laws of the universe. Markets are going to give us this sort of political system. In fact, it's been a project. It was heavily funded in the 1920s by the Ford Rockefeller Foundations. They met in Paris in Walter Lippmann Colloquium in 1938. And they now have so much control over mass media and academia that they, they can label populism. They can turn that into a pejorative. It was never a pejorative in the 19th century and in the early 20th century. Populism was about popular democracy. And a lot of the policies, if you look at Hyndman's policies, if you look at Bryan's policies in America, they're very much the same sort of policies that Roosevelt put into practice in the 1930s and Attlee and Bevin and the two Bevins, of course, put into practice in this country after 1945. So populism, we don't mean populism as a pejorative. We regarded Corbyn and Sanders in the USA, I think we misread him slightly, as populist because they were trying to appeal to the broad working class in the way that the left had failed to do since the inception of the new left in after 1968.
Okay, well, look, let's cut to the chase here because you've got another chapter here, Wrong Turns. I mean, I think most of us have got our own idea of what the Corbynist Labour Party did wrong and how it was undermined, etc. But, I mean, I think it's quite clear that Corbyn and Seamus Milne did take some fairly serious wrong turns. What do you think they were?
Well, they failed to live up to their populist credentials. They were supposed to be, in 2016 when Corbyn was, flavour of the month, everyone was rejoining the Labour Party and paying their £3 membership fee or whatever. He did make a lot of noises about supporting the working class, about regional banks, about economic development. Sanders was making the same noises in the United States of America. And people were convinced, and there was a coming together of the left the progressive new left, the sort of identity politics left, the momentum left, and the old traditional working class came together. The thing is, when you keep talking about economic issues, that's when left does come together. It's when you start talking about culture that, they fly apart. So that was good. And then over time, momentum became more popular. Milne and his sort of middle class latte drinking liberals became their voice became louder in Corbyn's party, and they started talking about identity politics, and they started to really move Corbyn away from what we call the popular classes, about the ordinary working class. They were interested in jobs, they're interested in industry, and they're interested in schools, education, health, all the rest of these basic things that the Workers' Party still talks about. They start talk about industrialization, they talk about health service, they talk about the services that we need in this country. If Corbyn had stuck to that, and if he hadn't listened to his advisers, the three amigos, Portes, Medway, and Ren Lewis,
can you just say who these people, tell us a bit more about those three?
Absolutely. Jonathan
Their full
Portes,
names,
Jonathan Portes, academic, James Medway, academic, and Simon Ren Lewis, professor of economics at Oxford. He used to work for the Treasury. The only professor in Oxford I know, he hasn't even got a PhD. But they told Corbyn, In the same way that Europe was telling Britain that you can't spend money without causing inflation. And John McDonald, who really doesn't know an awful lot about economics, even though he was the shadow chancellor, swallowed that. And they started reneging on their – I said, well, it's going to be $250 billion, but we can't spend it straight away. We might cause inflation. Of course, Rachel Reeves went across Wall Street a couple of months ago, got her instructions from the bankers over there, and came back and said, we can't spend any of this. We haven't got any money to spend, which is a complete nonsense, because nations are sovereign currency issues. We did this after World War II. We invested, used public investment to kickstart the economy. Between 1945 and 1960, we had more economic growth in that period, funded a lot of it, at least 40% of it, I think. I'm not sure about that figure entirely. Don't quote me on it. About 40% funded by public investment.
Okay, Steve, I'm just going to ask Martin to chip in here. This whole sort of trick of Rachel Reeves zipping over to the States in order to get her orders does sound a little bit like this is the sort of reason that people may not want to vote for this Starmer right Labour Party.
Well, I think she's nailed her colours to the mast. I mean, Yanis Varoufakis had a very good article in The Guardian a couple of weeks ago, because she was talking about maxing out the national credit card. And I'm quite sure that Steve will know that that's a if you know anything about economics, as you clearly do, that's just wrong. And, you know, people like Simon Ren Lewis on his blog go on about how wrong this is. I read his blog, and he's been pointing out how wrong Rachel is to come out with that stuff. And, of course, she will come to power as Shadow Chancellor, and she'll be forced to increase public expenditure because we've got a global capitalist crisis. There's no way they're going to be reducing it. The Japanese have been trying to reduce public expenditure since the 1980s, and every time they try and do it, the economy falls down the drain.
Well, it's no accident, is it, that she was one of the most vocal critics of Jeremy Corbyn, and she's now in charge. I mean, it almost seems theatrical. I'm reminded of Guy Debord and the Society of the Spectacle, you know, really sort of taking the mickey out of these people who don't actually seem to be in any way serious politicians. They seem to be playing games with the electorate. And you talk in another one of your chapters, Steve, about postmodernism, neoliberalism and the left. So this whole postmodernism idea incorporates all sorts, but one of the things is people will believe whatever it is we tell them to.
Well, sort of, yes. Oh, you've got me started now. I mean, postmodernism was fundamentally a French idea. I don't know how many of your listeners will remember the riots of 1968, but I'm sure most of them heard of the French riots. There could have been another revolution, but it stopped well short of that, of course. What happened was that the French intellectuals, who were always had powerful voices on the French political scene, had been for since the French Revolution, went out into the Renault factories and into the fields to talk to the workers, the French workers, and came back to Paris on the left bank and decided they didn't like them. Decided the working class was no longer the agent of history. So you had Pierre Victor, you had Michel Foucault, you had all of these sort of former Maoists and Marxists all changing their tune because they decided they hate the workers. They said they're all drunken Catholics, sexists, racists, and too many traditional ideas, and they don't understand our fancy new theories. Debord wasn't one of these, by the way. Debord and Raoul van Eygem, the situation is sort of strange fish. I know quite a lot about them, but we'll leave that to one side at the moment. Foucault and the rest, of course, decided that the working class were no longer the agent of history, and now the marginalised women, people with different ethnic backgrounds, are the ones that the left should put their, you know, should put their case to. And so we ended up with this thing called post-structuralism. So the class structure, you know, which was about the bourgeoisie and the proletariat, the sort of basic Marxist division. And what we in Britain knew as the workers and the upper class twits, who we were supposed to be against, you know. Remember Dennis Skinner giving them hell in Westminster. So they decided that, you know, now that the working class was finished. And that was the beginning of the alienation of the left from the working class. And the working class aren't stupid. They caught onto this. They started to read working class, read the literature, what was saying in the papers, what the left was saying about them. And the left became this sort of finger-wagging schoolmaster or schoolmistress talking to you must change your habits. You must become more progressive. We ended up with, because this was absorbed by the neoliberals were watching this very, very carefully. The American CIA were avid watchers of the French postmodernists. It filtered over the Atlantic. The Americans took it on board. And of course, that filtered back over here from America through academia into the education system. And we ended up with this sort of identity politics, intersectional conflict where nobody agrees about anything. And all of our shared concerns, which were fundamentally economic, all got lost in this forest of identity politics. And that kiboshed the left in America and Britain. Of course, it filtered across into Europe as well.
Yeah, so, I mean, what sounds to me what you're saying is that there was sabotage, some form of sabotage. But anyway, I mean, these people may have been well-intentioned. They may also have been rather helped on their way by the ruling classes that they were trying to undermine. Who knows? And yeah, you're right. You know, Guy Debord and the Situationists were very much, they were trying to do what I do, I suppose, every week, which is to show up this kind of pantomime side of things. And the idea is that we actually want people in power who are going to make the decisions which are going to be good for us, for our kids, etc. And there's this constant pressure,
yes,
by the ruling classes in the economic system.
Absolutely.
Nowadays, of course, it's the sort of intelligence techno community as well. So, you know, we're talking about the mass media, web giants, these kinds of people, to just simply feed our heads full of rubbish, as Whitney Webb was saying in our first hour. But look, what I want to come round to here is, at the end of the day, it's really about, surely, it's about economics. It's about where we get central government money from and what we do,
yes,
with it, whether we can actually manage to get ourselves a government that invests for the future of the country, for the population.
Absolutely,
that isn't
right,
just,
yeah,
in you know, trying to spend money on weapons for Ukraine and this sort of thing. So what do you make of that? Are there any voices out there making sense of this economic mission that the left should be on?
Well, of course, Winlow and I. I mean, in the final chapter, A Return to Economics, don't forget that the subtitle of the book is Why We Must Begin from the Beginning Again. We're not saying that the left is dead forever, but that version of the left that collapsed into this farrago of identity politics in the 80s and 90s, Judith Butler and all the rest. I recall a sentence from, what's his name, Debord's Society of Spectacle. The spectacle is that which avoids the work of men, or spit sexist, women as well, of course. So avoiding the work, what he meant was the political work. What you're saying is absolutely right. What we can work on, the foundation of all society is the economy. And that's what the left was about. It was throughout the 19th century, early 20th century, right up to the 1968, the left focused on the economy. And there are voices now trying to convince people, trying to tell people, instruct people how economies work. We have what's called a fiat monetary system now, which, you know, which came about when Nixon abandoned Bretton Woods and the gold standard. We have floating exchange, floating currencies. We can do a lot with this money. We are the state is the sovereign issuer of currency. And we can invest, as long as we invest in productive work, and that includes services, includes new industry and services, as long as we invest to create more supply, we won't cause inflation by increasing the amount of money in circulation. Because the inflation myth, you know, which goes back to Weimar, oh dear, we're going to create a new Weimar Republic or Venezuela or Zimbabwe. Inflation is fundamentally a supply-side problem. The Weimar Republic were paying debts in foreign currencies. The French had taken over half their industry. Their industry had collapsed. And the place was riddled with political corruption. And, of course, they conquered inflation in 1925 by revaluing their currency. So inflation wasn't the reason Hitler got in. Hitler got in because between 1929 and 1933, after the Wall Street crash, Germany was cast into a pit of mass unemployment and poverty. That's why Hitler got in. So they blame all of this on inflation. They tell us lies about inflation. Friedman saying, oh, that's about the quantity of money put into the system. That's always a reaction to supply-side problems. We saw supply-side problems due to COVID, and that's what kicked off the inflationary spike we've just seen because the supply chains were snarled up. So they tell us basically a pack of lies. As you say, misinformation, complete rubbish. We can use our currency to invest in our country, reboot the economy. We shouldn't have a manufacturing fetish, of course, because manufacturing these days isn't labor-intensive. But we can invest in high-tech industry, productivity, better services, national health. The whole country needs repaving, for God's sake.
Well, one of the things that I don't know what you make of this, one of my bugbears is that the actual cost of living is really what it's all about. We need to reduce to a minimum things like mortgage repayments, rents, all the electricity costs, gas costs, transport costs, all these things that we need just to literally tick over week after week have been bumped up, cranked up by the rentiers.
Because they only have one solution, which is sort of central bank raising interest rates. What does that do? It makes mortgages more expensive. It collapses businesses who can't borrow. It makes house rents more expensive. So the working people are punished, and they're punished for one reason only, is that money has three functions. It's basically a unit of exchange. It's a medium of exchange. It's a unit of account. It's a store of value. The people who use money as a store of value, who hoard it and lend it out for compound interest repayments, they're the ones who use money as a store of value. So they're protecting their savings and they're protecting their loan repayments because they want their loan repayments to be worth as much in 5 and 10 years' time as they are when they made the loan. So they're the ones who are benefiting from raising interest rates. Everyone else suffers. And you impose austerity on a country, you collapse business, you make everything more expensive, and then they push up prices, which is always the initial cause of inflation. They start pushing up prices. We've had a recent report saying that the luxury market is now pushing up price because the rich don't care about price increases, and so they're just buying more of this luxury stuff, and they're the ones really at this very moment risking a return to inflation.
Because of George, I think we should almost doff our caps to George Galloway for his persistence, and also for obviously a very, very hard campaign that they've fought in Rochdale. I mean, they popped this on probably at 2 o'clock in the morning on the mainstream press. I've heard very little of this. I was twiddling around this morning and over lunchtime to try and hear. Is George Galloway anywhere speaking? Couldn't hear him. So it's almost as if the mainstream media disinformation has sort of kicked off at 2 a.m. about who George Galloway is and what he stands for. So let's have a listen now to his acceptance speech, which is interrupted briefly by Just Stop Oil, who see him as very pro... he's not as into this whole zero carbon agenda as they are. So yes, I groaned as well when I saw that. I thought, this is typical, isn't it? It's a little bit like the Cyanim turning up at when we had a Hezbollah newspaper editor speaking in Bristol. The Zionists turn up to just disrupt it. But anyway, you'll hear a brief bit of disruption. But here's George Galloway's acceptance and victory speech, which he read out in Rochdale. Well, he didn't read out. He talks from the top. He's not a script reader. A bit like the old Jack Hargreaves on the television on Out of Town. He speaks from the heart.
Keir Starmer, this is for Gaza. You have paid, and you will pay, a high price for the role that you have played in enabling, encouraging, and covering for the catastrophe presently going on in occupied Palestine in the Gaza Strip. Rochdale town councillors, I put you on notice now that I hope to put together a grand alliance of all the parties I want to put the town councillors on notice that we intend to clean the town hall clock. I make, of course, no disrespect to the returning officer and his fine staff who ran this campaign today and this count this evening virtually flawlessly, nor any public servant in the town hall. But the councillors have to go, and I intend to try to put together a grand alliance that will change Rochdale for the better just 12 weeks from now at the local elections. I thank God for this great victory. I thank my wife, my 6 children, my 5 grandchildren, who've all been working in this campaign. I thank my agent, my campaign manager, my dear friend and wise counsel, Imtiaz. I thank all of my campaign team for the phenomenal work that they did. I thank the people of Rochdale who voted for me in such numbers, but promised to work faithfully for all Rochdalians and to work for the day where you can again be born in Rochdale. Again be born in Rochdale. I want to tell Mr. Starmer above all that the plates have shifted tonight. And as Jacob Rees-Mogg just said on television, in talking of me as a parliamentary orator of note, that Keir Starmer's problems just got 100 times more serious than they were before today. This is going to spark a movement, a landslide, a shifting of the tectonic plates in scores of parliamentary constituencies, beginning here in the Northwest, in the West Midlands, in London, from Ilford to Bethnal Green and Bow. Labour is on notice that they have lost the confidence of millions of their voters who loyally and traditionally voted for them generation after generation. I've heard some of the narrative being spun around this election result this evening. Yes, it's true that every Muslim is bitterly angry at Keir Starmer and his misnamed Labour Party. But you would be very foolish if you did not realise that millions of other citizens of our country are too. Keir Starmer and Rishi Sunak are two cheeks of the same backside, and they both got well and truly spanked tonight here in Rochdale. Finally, I congratulate David Tully on his remarkable achievement. His remarkable achievement in coming second in this by-election. And trust that even the most biased journalist in the room will realize that this is the first time ever in British political history that the two big parties of the state were thoroughly and soundly beaten. Yes. And I think that that will not have been missed in Downing Street and wherever Keir Starmer currently hangs out. I look forward to working with Mr. Tully, and I hope he'll join the Grand Alliance to wipe Rochdale's town hall clean, because this town has been badly let down. Once one of the most prosperous towns in England, now one of the poorest, whose heart has been piece by piece removed. The maternity, the A&D. I understand you can't even be locked up in Rochdale. There's not even a jail cell to toss a miscreant in. Mr. Danchuk might be glad to hear it. But the biggest new threat that we face is the possibility of the extinction of the proud Rochdale Football Club. And I pledge that I will work tirelessly, I hope with the Town Council, as changed, in 12 weeks' time, to save the Dale. God bless you. God bless Rochdale. God bless Gaza.
So there's George Galloway there with his... Marty, do you want to explain the joke about Simon Danchuk he's talking about there, who was stood for the Reform Party?
Yeah, well, Danchuk was previously the Labour MP for Rochdale, and he got booted out, I believe, because he was you know, sexually harassing some underage person. I think it was a girl, I'm not sure. But anyway, he stood for the Reform Party as an ex-Labour person, and, you know, he didn't do very well. So there you are.
So the figures were vote share of the vote for the Workers' Party, George Galloway, 40% for David Tully, who's an independent, he was just referring to there, just over 21%. The Tory was 12%. Ashar Ali, 7.7%, who I'd initially heard was polling pretty much level with Galloway. No, definitely not. He was down at about 8%. The Lib Dem, Ian Donaldson, at 7%, and Simon Danchuk for Reform UK just over 6%. The point he's making there, Steve, is I think that this whole idea of Team A, Team B political parties controlling Westminster, this is sending a very clear message that that's over.
Yes, I think so. And I think that most people, by bitter experience, and now know that the neoliberal duopoly isn't on their side. It's not, it hasn't got any real good intentions towards the working people of this country.
I mean, the point, of course, is about Rochdale, one of the most prosperous cities in the country, now one of the poorest.
Yes. Didn't the co-op originate in Rochdale?
Yeah, that's right.
Cooperative society. Yes, it always a prosperous place. We had prosperous places all over the north of England, Tony. And I remember visiting them, many of them, as a child. But what I would like to say, that was a great speech by George. We've got one of British politics' best orators back in Parliament, which is a great thing. And I wouldn't like to be in Keir Starmer's shoes at the moment, I'll tell you that. But what I'd like to say is that the Workers' Party is also a very serious party. If anyone visits our website, we have a 10-point program. You can buy a copy of the manifesto very cheaply. We're constantly working on it. We're setting up policy committees to look at how, if you look at the 10-point program, it's about renationalization of utilities. It's about clean energy. It's about boosting the economy of this country. It's about better education system. It's about the refunding the National Health Service, putting its back on its feet. We have some serious economic policies. We have some very good brains in the party who know how economics works. And we are a serious party, and we hope to have other victories in places like Rochdale throughout the country and eventually have some say in Parliament about how this the economy of Britain is run and managed.
Well, I'm very happy because the left seems to be now doing what the right was doing with the UKIP and the Brexit Party and actually getting active and actually, you know, getting into Parliament too with good old George. And one of his like lieutenants, I think, is we could call him, is the former MP for Derby, Chris Williamson. He was also, Chris, I think, the former leader of Derby City Council for the Labour Party until he started supporting Palestine. And of course, you know, the usual happened is he's getting removed. And in fact, it's amazing that people like Jeremy Corbyn at the top of the Labour Party at the time didn't actually stand up for him. I remember there's a brilliant article by Neil, second name escapes me, who talked about the Shakespearean tragedy of Jeremy Corbyn, who treated his enemies better than he treated his friends. So there's one of the major mistakes that Corbyn made. But anyway, here's Chris Williamson now speaking about this just before the announced result on I think it was on the BBC or Sky. No, Sky.
Well, I think they knew they were on course to lose and lose badly. So, you know, by disowning their candidate, it sort of gave them a get-out-of-jail card. But I don't think people are falling for that. What we believe we've seen here is a total rejection of the mainstream political party. You know, party politics, in my opinion, is on the way to its grave, and which is where it belongs. Because, frankly, as George has said, you know, two cheeks of the same backside. We deserve better than that. We deserve a proper democracy. And in elections, people deserve a choice. And when the Labour Party and the Conservative Party are effectively offering the same thing. We're effectively in a one-party state. And that's why people, I think, are looking for an alternative. And as I say, that's what George Galloway and the Workers' Party provides.
So is that pretty much just setting out your stall, Steve?
Yeah, I think so. And I mean, Chris is one of the most honest and morally upstanding politicians we've ever seen in this country. These are the sort of people, you know, began with Tony Benn, Peter Shaw being sort of attacked by the SDP split, and then Kinnock getting in 83, wasn't it? And we saw the really good, honest, intelligent, knowledgeable politicians being pushed out of the Labour Party to give us this sort of stage show of Blair and Mandelson and the rest of these rather weird characters who really were never serious politicians.
But watching Sky, watching that on Sky last night before the result, actually he seemed to know which way things were going. Chris Williamson had a bit of a twinkle in his eye.
Absolutely. Well, he did, and Chris is, he's off air with economics, you know, so how to put the country back on its feet. We all, a number of us in the party, know how to do this, and I hope we can go on to win more parliamentary seats. And I'm not a big fan of PR, Tony, but it wouldn't be a bad idea for a while to get to do a bit of power brokering, to get some independent voices into Parliament, and to push these two mainstream, these dead mainstream parties further to the margins. And power broking, some people argue that in Italy nothing ever gets done, but I think we could run it differently in this country, and we could start to get some sensible voices in Parliament.
Look, I'm going to be back on its feet. Very unkind to you now, and I'd like you to comment, if you don't mind, on the farmer protest. I hadn't asked you about it beforehand, but we've seen a massive protest this week. Yesterday, so that's Thursday, outside the Senedd in Cardiff by the Welsh Farmers. Yep. They are absolutely disgusted by the Labour, the way that the Labour Party over in Wales is telling farmers that, for example, they've got to take 20% of their land out of circulation. They're not allowed to use it for farming anymore. Well, hang on a minute. You know, this is... many of these farmers are saying, well, they're already finding it difficult to make a living, to pay mortgages or whatever it happens to be, to make farming pay. And so we're going to hear now from outside the Senedd, which wasn't carried live, unfortunately. It was some fantastic speeches from various of the farmers. So I hope you don't mind me asking, is it okay to ask you about this?
Well, it is. And I make a general point, of course, that the farmers in this country, in Holland, in across Europe, the Canadian truckers are denounced as populist. Do you remember the Gilets Jaunes a few years ago? They were a compendium of French workers who were just fed up with the whole neoliberal thing. They're fed up with rising interest rates, mortgage they couldn't afford, cost of living. Everything's austerity, everything's going wrong. And there's no need for this. So, yes, I sympathise with the Welsh farmers greatly.
Well, let's have a listen. Let's actually people, have a listen to them.
We shouldn't be telling farmers how to run their
Well, I mean, they seem to be quite good at actually producing food. And
they're
the idea that they're now being made bankrupt.
Yeah.
Well, of course, this is all wonderful for the private equity firms that want to buy up.
Like Bill Gates has done in the United States.
Exactly.
He's built thousands of acres of land. They did this in Romania years ago. In fact, they did this in Poland 200 years ago, which caused a huge... We've had land enclosures for a long time. Huge, wealthy people buying up land and mismanaging. I mean,
it seems to me that both in urban and rural areas, the people who are losing their homes that can't afford to pay their mortgages in the urban areas, and also the farmers being forced out too, well, of course, that land is going to go to somebody. It's going to go to those people that don't pay any tax and are awash with cash, like Larry Fink,
absolutely,
BlackRock, Vanguard, and the rest of them. Anyway, let's go over... yesterday, live outside the Senedd in Cardiff Bay.
So I'm a fifth-generation farmer from Mid Wales. I'm farming sheep, cattle and free-range hens. And there's a couple of reasons I'm here. I've got a two-year-old son sitting at home who loves every minute of being on the farm. And I am fighting for his future on that farm. I'm also here to make sure us farmers stick together and unite through this time of hardship. Regardless of who we are, where we come from, what we farm, or what we believe in. Now is the time to stick together. I'm very nervous, I'm just a farmer, so bear with me.
Throw it, mate.
I look around here in the crowd, and you're all like me. You're just fighting for our right to produce food in Wales. These new schemes and incentives that are getting pushed upon us are here for one thing and one thing only, to kill us off, and I say enough is enough.
Yay! Nice one, mate.
Someone's speaking some sense.
Exactly.
The government tell us we need to work better with nature and fight a climate crisis. So I parked in Adams Street and I've walked to the Senedd today through about 10 tonne of litter.
True that.
Farmers are the heart and soul of our local communities, and I for one are fed up of being treated like the villain. Where do the people thinking up these schemes think their food is going to come from when there's farms ravaged by TB and we're busy pruning trees?
Yeah. That's it, man.
Not only are we fighting for our farms, we're fighting for our communities, our local shops, our local schools, our markets and everything in between. How many non-farmers are going to go to Wednesday and CCF to keep them afloat? We've just had to listen to four politicians promise the world and try and get your support just for votes. Well, I challenge each and every one of you to actually stick to your promises, get out of the cycle and do something. I got asked yesterday, is this a protest, a threat to the Welsh Government? And I had no idea how to answer. So I'll tell you this, Welsh Government. Look at us all here today, together as one. There are thousands of us here fighting for the same thing, a common goal, to ensure our future in Wales farming. And if you don't start working with us, this is just the beginning.
Yes.
So that's recorded in Cardiff Wednesday, I think, not yesterday. Maybe you could say something what you make of this whole thing, Steve. It's probably the first time in several generations that between 3,000 and 4,000 farmers were all gathered there in Cardiff Bay together.
Yes, I think they have every right to do that, because what we're seeing now is a centralised command economy. One of the worst things about the Soviet Union was Gosplan, the central command economy, trying to second guess what everyone what needs to buy on a daily basis, and sending commands to the production system to produce this. It just didn't work. You'd have people queuing up for sausages in a shop in Vladivostok, and a lorry load of boot polish would arrive because someone's made a mistake. Now, we haven't got a communist central command economy. What we now have, the WEF, Schwab, and the neoliberals, the private equity corporations, we have a central command capitalist economy, and they're basically looking to carve up farmland. Fink and his pals are already in Ukraine looking to buy up farmland in Ukraine after the war. They're already planning things in Gaza development. They've bought up most of Patagonia and Argentina, and now that lunatic Milei is trying to, you know, is threatening to sell the rest of Argentina off to these people. This is a global money management, global investment corporations who are looking to buy up, and they're telling, they're bankrupting small businesses, they're putting workers out of work, they're deindustrializing where they want and industrializing places where they have cheap wages and cheap materials. They're doing what they want in this world. And they're doing what they want because they've disempowered politics and politicians. The democratic deficit is something they've organized over the past 40 years.
Well, I agree with you. Anyway, I just want to crack on because I've got another farmer here about to speak.
I want to be positive because I want to see a future for my children on the land, farming and producing food. So I'm going to tell you a story. A story that started a month ago on my phone, on WhatsApp. I wish I hadn't opened it now. Two men standing over there, Gwyn and Rhys. They're the boys that started, digon you digon, enough is enough. And I want you to put your hands together for them boys. They planted a seed in a field that was south-facing in good soil. And that seed's here now. That seed has grown into an oak because everybody travelled, everybody came here for a reason. Because we love what we do. That's why people get fed. I will tell you, my father has never had a passport. He's never been abroad. And he said to me when they brought this, you know, 10% trees, I haven't worked this land, and my forefathers have, for people to come here and plant trees. Because we've worked our hands to the bone to get that land to produce food. A mae hwnna'n bwysig. Ein tir need you. It's our land. And we produce the food. Let us be strong, and let me tell you, I've got a few followers, and everybody's behind us. The general public understand that they're going to need a farmer once, twice, or three times every day of their lives. And if we don't stick together, and it's been a tough month for me, I will tell you, I nearly walked away. But we will be strong. We will stick together, drive forward. And I'm going to be honest with you now. It's time for change. Digon, you digon. Awn ni adref, and I will go home from here with our hearts full of joy. We have done something special. Da ni di neud rhywbeth. Fydda ni gofio am yn oes for the rest of our lives. We were part of a farming food revolution, and we will bring this to the nation, to the people, and feed them sustainably, environmentally friendly, and affordably. Dwi'm yn mynd I falu cachu ddim mwy. Diolch o galon. A diolch I chi am be da chi'n neud. Hefo'ch gilydd. dan ni'n mynd I wneud gwahaniaeth. Together, we will make a difference. Diolch yn fawr.
Wow, well, that's quite a feeling, a sort of vibe coming out from the Welsh farmers there. What's the bigger agenda, Steve, going on here? I mean, it's obviously lovely to hear the Welsh language there and lovely to see all these people coming together, but it's almost as if they're saying, well, we're going to have to go round this Welsh government. They're in the way.
I think so, and this is a classic case of recognition of the democratic deficit and the need to replace the government and the powers. Let's be honest, the government isn't in charge of this country. The government are working on behalf of bankers, private equity corporations. We see Ray Reeves as an ex-banker. We see Theresa May's husband was Margaret Thatcher. Dennis Thatcher was a banker. These are the people pulling the strings. And when and the Welsh farmer, oh, that was a great speech, by the way. Saying this land is our land, it reminds me of Woody Guthrie's song. This land is our land, yes. And it should be our land. But the problem is, it isn't. And to get this land back and to start to manage this country, manage its economy on behalf of the people, we need a democratic government, economically literate government that knows exactly.
Yeah, it's serving us rather than the private equity. So
absolutely.
We've also got, absolutely. I mean, there's something interesting also going on here. So in terms of civilization, what does that mean? Well, one of the things it means is a food surplus, and the farmers provide that, but they're being attacked. We also, in order to have a civilization, we've got to have decent housing and some sort of infrastructure in the cities. Well, all that's being undermined and under attack, Martin. I mean, largely, this has got quite a lot to do with 2008, don't you think? The bailouts, Gordon Brown's bailouts, and also there were further bailouts under the cover of COVID, actually in 2019, which weren't really properly. So what's happened is the entire system, particularly local government and regional government, has been plunged into a debt trap.
Well, that's right. And, of course, the farmers protesting there, one of the big things that have been hitting them is the increase in energy prices, which is directly caused by the US blowing up the Nord Stream pipeline in the Baltic Sea. I mean, the dogs in the street know what goes on and what imperialism actually is. The European economy is about to be plunged into depression by the Americans so that they can cannibalise everything that they can take.
Well, one of the main things is
a wartime situation.
One of the main things is the fuel prices, and what they're saying is that you're going to have to get rid of your diesel tractors and get electric ones.
Yeah, I understand.
The farmers don't believe that that's realistic.
No, I understand there's arguments about the net zero and planting trees and so on, but I think you've got to recognise that farmers in developed countries like Britain and Germany are subsidised. If there was a free market, a global free market, we'd be buying all of our stuff from New Zealand, Australia and Argentina.
And Russia.
And Russia, of course, except if we were allowed to buy their stuff. I think
it's, I mean, this is partly what it is. It's a lot of these sanctions, really. So it's a form of protectionism, isn't it?
Well, of course it is. And it's actually worked very well for the Russian farming now is not family farming, and it's not cooperative farming as it used to be, the sovkhoz and so on. It's actually big private sector farms which are run for profit, but they're modelled on what used to happen in the Soviet Union. So if you think about Russia, it's a very flat place, and the skills of individual farming have died a long time ago, but what they've done is turn what they have got into a world-beating system. And
we'd beat the world if it was allowed to, but now they put them under sanctions.
They're hell of a lot of food all over the world.
Steve, if you want to just sum up, and maybe you could also tell us about how we can get hold of your book.
Well, you can get a hold of our book from Bristol University Press. And all online and high street bookshops. If there are any high street bookshops.
Well, it's called The Death of the Left. You also got a subtitle, haven't you? What's that?
Well, why we must begin from the beginning again. In a sense, the subtitle's more important than the title, because we do in the final chapter suggest how we can reboot the British economy. And there are ways we can do this. This can be done. We've done it before. We did it in 1945. We can't do it in exactly the same way because we have different system, different circumstances. But we can do it. And we do make some very, very strong and clear suggestions about how we might do that.
Okay, well, that's brilliant. Thank you, Steve Hall, very much for joining us. Just before the break, we've got a little poem about George Galloway from Patrizia Opulenza this week. It's called George Galloway, Orator for Palestine. George, in wait, has lain so long, a dish served cold to right the wrongs against him done by the Labour crew, who ousted George with much ado. On Iraq, the facts he oft would speak, while Labour buried truth so deep. A killing spree in Iraq we saw, a million deaths and many more. TB, the Crim, who feasts on death, still believes he did his best. George on truth, we always hear, on genocide, in Gaza, clear. The Workers' Party, in opposition to Labour's failings, this much is true. Smarmer, in own foot, has shot, as lobbyists the power got. On free speech, we hear him swear, but define a woman, he will not dare. Candidates now dismissed at will, funding to the party still, from forces who pull rank, tis clear, Israel lobby, tis ever near. Symbolic now of anger felt, on genocide in Gaza, melt. Wrath for every death now spills, votes for George, the people's will. The world has seen this genocide, Israel no more can try to beat us with their broken stick. The world now views Israel as sick. George the dragon seems has slayed, as many prayers for him are made. No hissy fits or bumbled voices will stop the voters be swayed on choices. The time now come for George, who waited with bated breath, anticipated, to take the high road as government sleeps on Gazan's death, dark secrets keep, as lobbyists keep the pressure on. No one but George speaks out on wrongs, death and bombs, more children killed, as food supplies now burnt at will. How can the House of Commons hold MPs so weak, while George, so bold, speaks out and up for Palestine as MPs ignore these vile war crimes? Perhaps George G, some don't rate, but at least he's willing to debate. MPs and leaders who cower in corners, shameless, as George speaks out on fauners.
Thank you. The first lesson is written in the first chapter of the Book of Job, beginning at the first verse. There was once a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job. That man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. There were born to him 7 sons and 3 daughters. He had 7,000 sheep, 3,000 camels, 500 yoke of oxen, 500 donkeys, and very many servants, so that this man was the greatest of all the people of the East. One day the heavenly beings came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came among them. The Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From going to and fro on the earth, and from walking up and down on it." The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man who fears God and turns away from evil." Then Satan answered the Lord, "Does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not put a fence around him and his house and all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands and his possessions. They have increased in the land. But stretch out your hand now and touch all that he has, and he will curse you to your face." The Lord said to Satan, "Very well, all that he has is in your power. Only do not stretch out your hand against him." So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. One day, when his sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in the eldest brother's house, a messenger came to Job and said, "The oxen were ploughing and the donkeys were feeding beside them, and the Sabaeans fell on them and carried them off and killed the servants with the edge of the sword, and I alone have escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, another came and said, "The Chaldeans formed 3 columns, made a raid on the camels, and carried them off, and killed the servants with the edge of a sword. I alone have escaped to tell you." While he was still speaking, another came and said, "Your sons and daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house, and suddenly a great wind came across the desert, struck the 4 corners of the house, and it fell on the young people, and they are dead. I alone have escaped to tell you." Then Job arose, tore his robe, shaved his head, and fell on the ground and worshipped. He said, "Naked I came from my mother's womb, and naked shall I return there. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord." In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrongdoing.
Nobody wants to know the happy end. The country's home for you, spite. The second lesson is written in the 21st chapter of the Gospel of St. Luke, beginning at the 34th verse. Jesus warned his disciples, "Be on your guard, so that your hearts are not weighed down with dissipation and drunkenness and the worries of this life, and that day does not catch you unexpectedly, like a trap. For it will come upon all who live on the face of the whole earth. Be alert at all times, praying that you may have the strength to escape all these things that will take place and to stand before the Son of Man." Every day Jesus was teaching in the temple, and at night he would go out and spend the night on the Mount of Olives, as it was called. And all the people would get up early in the morning to listen to him in the temple. Now the festival of unleavened bread, which is called the Passover, was near. The chief priests and the scribes were looking for a way to put Jesus to death, for they were afraid of the people. Then Satan entered into Judas, called Iscariot, who was one of the 12. He went away and conferred with the chief priests and officers of the temple police about how he might betray him to them. They were greatly pleased and agreed to give him money. So he consented and began to look for an opportunity to betray him to them when no crowd was present. Here ends the second lesson.
So what we had was a little bit of Winchester Cathedral, the choral evening song from Wednesday there, but the and Jerusalem from also from Winchester Cathedral Choir, but the mysterious song in the middle is a terrific band called BIS, B-I-S, who were around about 2000, and that's called TNC Revolution. And so that's the Join the Teensy Revolution. I think that's the Scottish doing their little revolution after the Welsh revolution we saw. Now, Martin, this whole idea of revolution, does it work, or is it or someone always going to hijack your revolution? Is it better to do it the Galloway way, bit by bit, through political power?
Well, I mean, the word revolution gets used, you know, in different meanings. So, you know, we're often not using it in the same way.
A massive upheaval, I suppose. But the thing is, the other side is often ready to control that upheaval and determine the outcome, isn't it?
Well, I mean, the Marxist theory of revolution, which I suppose is the you know what you I mean, you have revolutions in marketing and revolutions
oh,
in.
Come on, we're not talking about.
Yes,
marketing.
I know. So if we're talking about revolution as revolution, the traditional definition of revolution was the overturning of one regime and its replacement by another, and the idea of revolution was that it's going round in a circle, yeah? But the Marxist idea of revolution, which derived from the French Revolution, is it's all going somewhere, and that revolutions happen when the social structure and the economic structure has outrun the political structure which is holding it up. So there was a bourgeois revolution where private property and capitalists took over the state from the feudal classes, although the feudal classes never went away, which is another issue that hasn't been addressed. And then, you know, the proletarian revolution was when the workers would overthrow the bourgeoisie in their turn and take power, and the workers would be the last class in history, because the proletariat was the universal class. This is actually derived from philosophical ideas in Hegel. But I mean, the fact is that revolution in practice often just means it's something violent, and that's when we use the word revolution.
Yeah, like a coup.
Well, or something like the Chinese Communist Party taking over China and executing the landlord class.
Now, you sent me something this week about the Maidan coup. Apparently, some more information has come out about that.
That's right, yeah. This is
2014 in Kiev.
Yes, it's 10 years ago now that the coup took place in Kiev. In which the new regime took power. And we've known for a long time, because it's on, you know, there's been various revelations that the massacre of the pro-EU protesters in the Maidan Square was carried out not by the then pro-Russian government, but by the new regime. And of course, there's also evidence to suggest that it wasn't just them that did it. They were working with NATO intelligence services to murder these people, which is why when you say, did the West murder Navalny? That's not a stupid question, because they were quite prepared to murder pro-EU demonstrators who were demonstrating against the Russian government in order to discredit the government and then seize power. That's how NATO special forces operations are run. And of course, Kachanovsky, who's written this article which I sent to you, he is actually Ukrainian, although he's an academic in Canada. And he's looked at all of the evidence, and it's quite clear that that massacre was carried out by NATO, not by the Russians at all.
And I have to say, and actually don't have to say anything, but I'm going to say it, welcome back to Not the BCFM Politics Show, for those that want to bypass the psycho in the corner on the talkradio.org.uk stream, and live on the Not the BCFM Politics Show app, available free from all good app stores like Aurora, please not Google. And you're listening to Irish Republican Labour activist Martin Summers and me, Tony Gosling. Now, my name is Aaron Bushnell. I'm an active duty member of the United States Air Force, and I will no longer be complicit in genocide. I'm about to engage in an extreme act of protest, but compared to what people have been experiencing in Palestine at the hands of their colonisers, it's not extreme at all. That's how the 25-year-old introduced himself and bade farewell to the world in a live stream video of his Sunday afternoon walk to the Israeli embassy in Washington, D.C. Arriving outside the front gate, Bushnell set down his phone, took 8 paces, turned to face the camera, doused himself in an unknown accelerant, donned his service cap. It took him something like 30 seconds to actually get the lighter to work, and eventually he set himself alight. He repeatedly screamed, "Free Palestine," as he burnt Martin.
Well, obviously, this has been a big event this week. In the Middle East, it's been taken notice of. Both Hamas and Nasrallah have, you know, basically said what a brave and principled person he was. Of course, the media in the West have been forced to report it, but they've actually done everything they possibly can to play it down. You know, he must have had mental health issues, this sort of thing, and they're looking into his past to see, you know. But, I mean, it is a very powerful statement by serving. He was in cybersecurity, so he was doing the sort of things that Daniel Egan's husband does for the Israelis. He was doing that for the US Air Force.
It's interesting. I mean, one of the comments on the page I'll put up on our show page at thisweek.org.uk, the American media won't question the mental health of those who gleefully blow up neighbourhoods full of children and hunt, humiliate, torture and kill for sport. But they will question Aaron Bushnell, they will question his mental health.
Well, they will, and they'll do their very best to just push this under the carpet. Somebody else also burned themselves outside the Israeli consulate in Atlanta some while ago, but they are still alive, but very seriously injured, and they basically just hushed it all up. What this guy's done, because he's obviously a pro, basically, he realises if I turn up in my uniform and do this, people are going to have to take some notice. And they certainly have taken notice in the Middle East, where he's become, he's definitely regarded as a hero and a martyr.
Notice after Aaron Bushnell burns himself alive to protest Israel, how everyone cheerleading Israel's carpet bombings in Gaza have, overnight, become mental health experts.
Yes, that's Katie Johnson's blog, which I follow. What he's done is he's challenged those who are opposed to what's going on in Palestine to, you know, take it to another level. You know, we really are not going to walk by on the other side of the road while the thugs in charge in Israel massacre these people with impunity.
Well, the latest is the United States has vetoed a UN resolution condemning Israel for its Flour Massacre. Nearly 1,000 Palestinians were killed and wounded after Israeli forces opened fire on people surrounding an aid convoy. The US vetoed a UN Security Council resolution condemning Israel for a massacre of civilians surrounding an aid convoy in Gaza, a motion supported by all other member states. The Israel Defense Forces has acknowledged its soldiers fired on the crowd. On Thursday, hundreds of Palestinians were killed and injured by Israeli soldiers as they gathered around an aid convoy near Gaza City. As some people took aid off the trucks, the IDF claimed the same Palestinians approached Israeli soldiers nearby, saying its troops felt endangered, and so they opened fire. The killing has been dubbed the Flour Massacre. More than 100 Palestinians were killed in the shooting and ensuing panic, while about 750 others had been injured. Tel Aviv had attempted to blame the Palestinians for the deaths, saying the violence was caused by the mob.
Well, like the mob of pro-Palestine demonstrators that Rishi Sunak was going on about on Wednesday. Yes, mobs get everywhere, don't they? These mobs who want their food. Well, you've got to restore order when you've got a mob, Tony. And, of course, that's all the Israelis have done here. They've just restored order, although there's a big question mark on whether this is just people being trigger-happy or whether this is part of a plan. Because, of course, this aid convoy was provided by the Israeli military. It's not the normal UN. There's been a similar massacre up in Rafah with a UN convoy where the Israeli military opened fire. And I think it's pretty clear from all the evidence we have that they are trying to kill as many people as possible. So when they bring an aid convoy and that, and people come forward to try and get help, get some food, they kill them. Yeah, because they want them all dead. And that is exactly what they're trying to do. They're trying to kill as many people as possible. The denial of food to the population is clearly collective punishment, as was in the SNP's abortive resolution to Parliament the other week. And that's why Starmer didn't want to go down that road, because if it's collective punishment, then it's a war crime, and then Britain has to act. In legal terms.
Not sure who it is, but one of the journalists I was reading yesterday was calling out this narrative, as you were just doing, which is in the by British parliamentarians, saying that actually parliamentarians are in Britain are at risk. In fact, this was all part of last week's theatre to do with stopping a resolution being voted on by the Scottish National Party in Westminster, which would have condemned the Israel's actions as collective punishment of Palestine, which is a war crime. So the cover that which was provided by the Speaker, Lindsay Hall, for that was he was concerned about the safety of MPs who might be threatened by pro-Palestine protesters. And in a way, this is now taken off as a story. This is, we're going to have to legislate to make sure MPs are protected. Actually, these MPs are part of the genocide that are being part of the collusion to stop these votes taking place in Parliament.
I think it's absurd. If you want to be a member of parliament, you're entitled to whatever views you want. You can vote against the ceasefire in Gaza if you want, but you can't imagine that we are just going to say that's all right then. We're not going to do that. It's not reasonable, is it? And of course, it's very risky being a parliamentarian. As we know, Joe Cox was murdered by a pro-Brexit fanatic. The Tory guy was murdered by an Islamist fanatic. There is obviously a threat.
Yeah, but there could be intelligence behind that, as we know. In the run-up to this next coming general election, we could see terrorist attacks, which are designed to steer the outcome of the election.
Indeed. And of course,
not just by lone nutters, as we're told that some of these people are.
Yes. And of course, people like Gerry Adams had two assassination attempts on him. I mentioned Kitson earlier. I mean, it's absolutely absurd to imagine that parliamentarians who want to vote against a ceasefire in Britain, when the rest of the world, including virtually all former British colonies, apart from the majority white ones in Australia, Canada and New Zealand, they're all on the side of South Africa.
Well, it seems to me the Israelis are counting on being able to carry on with this genocide and, in fact, do it even more racist atrocities and massacres through two main reasons. One is the Israel lobby within the main two political parties here in Britain, and the other is through the press.
Well, that's right, but it's what's happening is that that's totally out of line with popular opinion. All opinion polls show that 70 to 80% of people in Britain agree with other countries around the world, for example, Ireland, that there should be an immediate ceasefire. And the British position, backed up by the Labour front bench, that we can't have a ceasefire because if we had a ceasefire, Hamas would be allowed to continue to exist. I feel, as I said last week, Hamas are the elected government of Palestine. They have, in their wisdom, decided to fight because their backs are against the wall. It's our duty, in fact, to support them. And I'm afraid, and if we're not going to support them, at least not to support the people who are trying to murder them. But, of course, that's not the case. But what is going to happen now, and I think what happened in Rochdale is bringing this home, is this is going to be the issue of this election. For the Tories, for Labour, for everybody, because it's a World War III issue. Just as going to war with Russia, it should be a central issue for this election, because I ain't going to go to war with Russia. I've got no interest in it. Maybe we should go to war with Israel, as we went to war with Serbia in the 1990s, as we went to war with Libya for the same sort of crimes, supposedly, using air power to attack people on the ground who don't have any air power. We put a no-fly zone in Iraq, we put a no-fly zone in Libya, why can't we put a no-fly zone in Gaza? Akrotiri, the RAF Air Force base, is just there. We could put a no-fly zone in just like that. And if the Israelis dared to shoot us down, saying we're going to war with you, we've got business to settle with you from the 1940s when you killed loads of our soldiers. And we walked away. Maybe we're not going to walk away this time. Well, can you imagine a British Prime Minister talking like that? Why not?
The Financial Times has revealed this week Vladimir Putin's forces have rehearsed using tactical nuclear weapons at an early stage of conflict with a major world power, according to leaked Russian military files that include training scenarios for an invasion by China. The classified papers seen by the FT describe a threshold for using tactical nuclear weapons that's lower than Russia has ever publicly admitted, according to experts who reviewed and verified the documents. Well, this could be disinformation, but Putin, in his State of the Nation address yesterday, was warning the NATO powers, you send your troops into Ukraine and you could start a nuclear war by so doing.
Well, I think he's right to warn them about that. But as I understand it, Russian strategic doctrine has always been clear. We will never use these in a first strike. But don't forget, they don't need to use tactical nuclear weapons. They are grinding NATO's forces to pieces using conventional weapons.
Criteria for a potential nuclear response, according to these documents, ranges from an enemy incursion into Russian territory, or to more specific triggers, such as the destruction of 20% of Russia's strategic ballistic missile submarines. So, I mean, for any kind of boundary where NATO is on the border of Russia, any kind of move across that border by the NATO powers could trigger a nuclear war.
Yeah, but not because the Russians will have a fit of spite and start a nuclear war. The danger is that once you've got the NATO countries directly fighting with Russia, I mean, they already are, as Putin says, we know they're all in there. I mean, they killed quite a lot, about 50 French mercenaries the other week. These were very top specialists for firing off missiles and so on. The Russians aren't going to let them go out and fire those missiles. They hit the hotel where they were killed.
It also seems that the FT here might be trying to create discord between Russia and China, saying that actually they're prepared to use these weapons potentially against China.
Do you know what I think about this, Tony? I think the FT have been handed a load of rubbish by the MI6 and told to run with it, and that's what they've done. But, of course, it's just their... they want to present the... We have secret documents that show this, that and the other. Where did you get them? Oh, MI6 gave them to us. Do you believe MI6? I don't.
Okay, some more headlines
today. Why do
you
believe them?
The US expects Israel to invade Lebanon, apparently.
Well, that's definitely on the cards because, you know, the right wing in Israel want this war to turn into a war in Lebanon and a war in Iran. And that's why it's going to be a top issue in the British general election. We've got to ask people, whatever level of society they're on, do you want a war with Iran and Russia? Because if you do, you know, you're a fool. And if you don't, you better wake up and do something about it right now.
Pentagon's Lloyd Austin is saying Israel has killed over 25,000 women and children in Gaza now.
Well, that's right, and there's going to be a lot more as the food situation and the water situation. They've got no water, they've got no potable water, they've got no food coming in. People are just going to start dying of disease, and that is part of the plan. We were talking about it. This is as a planned operation. This is the plan: is to kill as many as possible, drive the rest into Egypt, and then deal with the West Bank. Then try and force Lebanon up to the Litani River. We're going to hold the Golan Heights. This is a war for greater Israel, and we are part of it on the Israeli side. Now, we're in the wrong here, just as the Germans and the Japanese were in the wrong in World War II, and we will deserve to lose.
I was looking around for a good translation, live translation of Putin's speech yesterday. Almost impossible to find. There was just one with some kind of burbling guy who actually was great long gaps in what he was saying, and he didn't really seem to convey the sense of Putin. There was no Putin in the background. There was no applause in the background. That side of it was completely cut off. So I thought I wouldn't do that. But I will read out what Putin said about the nuclear war. The strategic nuclear forces are on full combat alert, and the ability to use them is assured, Putin told Russia's Federal Assembly, which includes both chambers of the Russian Parliament. Later in the speech, Putin specifically addressed the talk of NATO sending troops to Ukraine. They are selecting targets to strike on our territory and contemplating the most efficient means of destruction, he said, likely referring to US and NATO intelligence support for the Ukrainians. Now, they have started talking about the possibility of deploying NATO military contingents to Ukraine. But we remember what happened to those who sent their contingents to the territory of our country once before. Today, any potential aggression will face far graver consequences. They must grasp that we also have weapons. Yes, they know this. And as I've just said, capable of striking targets on their territory. Putin said the West was spooking the world with the threat of a conflict involving nuclear weapons, which potentially means the end of civilization. Don't they realise this? He finished.
Well, that's right. He's not threatening that he's going to use nuclear weapons. He's saying...
Well, Macron was threatening he'd send French troops there.
Well, yes, and he's saying, well, if you do that, we're not necessarily going to nuke France straight away, but we could end up with a situation where, we are fighting, one of the obvious things to do if France, for example, was to send its troops to the Ukraine, is the Russians are just going to start hitting air bases and whatever military infrastructure is inside of France. So they'll just whack all that straight away. Then the French will try and fire back, and they won't be able to because the Russian air defence will shoot it all down. So just using conventional weapons, that would wipe out the French military because the Russians are capable of doing that. The question is, at that point, do the French threaten to use nuclear weapons? Because if they do, the Russians say, well, don't you think about that because we've got loads more than you've got.
Anyway,
if it came to a nuclear war, there would be no winners. Putin knows that. He's not a fool.
After this massacre of over 100 people... nearly 1,000 injured altogether, the Flour Massacre yesterday. Joe Biden's walked back his prediction that a Gaza ceasefire will be reached by Monday. I mean, I was listening to this early in the week as Biden is saying, oh, it looks like there might be a ceasefire deal. Really, Biden? You're just talking up the Israeli line. And of course, in a way, it could be that this massacre was ordered by the Israelis because they don't want to have an agreement, a ceasefire.
Well, that's right. Those who want this war to happen, and they don't just mean a war on Gaza, they mean a war on Lebanon, a war on Iran, it's in their interest to escalate. Yeah? And they've got, they've got the troops on the ground to shoot people, so let's get on with shooting them. And that will, of course, escalate, and then the Americans will have to support us, and the British will go, yes, us too.
Well, although...
as we've done in Yemen.
Although RT and Sputnik are blocked, of course you can get around them with a Tor browser or some other way, of using our VPN, virtual private network, that sort of thing. Ministry of Foreign Affairs of the Russian Federation, the Russian Foreign Ministry, that gigantic, great big building in Moscow. People may know what I'm talking about. An intensification, they say today, of the use of toxic chemicals by Ukrainian armed formations. Actually, this is a press release yesterday in relation to the subsequent insinuations of the Kiev regime by the behest of Western special services. The armed forces of the Russian Federation allegedly used riot control agents, RCAs, during the special military operation. We would like to remind that as far back as October 2023, the most exhaustive records of continuous provocations organised by the Ukrainian militants using toxic chemicals and these riot control agents in order to blame Russian servicemen such crimes in violation of Article 1 of the Chemical Weapons Convention. These were distributed to the OPCW, the Chemical Weapons Watchdog, as well as the UN Security Council and General Assembly. These and other documents, as well as links to the relevant video records, are provided in short form on the official website of the Russian Foreign Ministry and the Defence Ministry of the Russian Federation. So loads of evidence of this now, Martin, that in fact lots of pictures of manuals, drones, even orders for these special drones that they want to fly over the Russians and release these chemical weapons, one of which actually, when it's released, turns to something called phosgene, which was something which was used in World War One. Now, we're not hearing much about this. We've had, over the last decade or so, all sorts of chemical weapons scares in Syria, but no talk about the Ukrainians spraying Russian soldiers with chemical weapons in the battlefield.
Well, there may be, because they're desperate, they're looking for anything that might give them some kind of, you know, route out of complete defeat. I won't say road to victory, because that's absurd. What the other thing that's very clear, as we said earlier, is that the Western Special Services, including MI6, they're involved in the creation of incidents where they can blame the Russians, yeah? So they kill their own people. The Kramatorsk attack, where a missile blew up all these people who were trying to get on a train to get out of get out of Dodge, that was blamed on the Russians, except that somebody took a photograph and it's quite clear it was a Ukrainian missile which had been deliberately targeted at civilians so they could then blame the Russians for killing civilians, which is what they did. And many people out there now, if they remember the incident, think, oh yes, there were all those civilians killed, it was done by the Russians.
Well, there was just
wasn't done by the Russians, it was done by the Ukrainians, it was done deliberately.
One of the riot
doubt with MI6's
control
support.
Chemicals is called Picrin, was first used, apparently, by the Ukrainian neo-Nazis, according to the Russian Foreign Ministry, during the siege of the Odessa Trade Union House on the 2nd of May 2014 against those who disagreed with the armed coup d'etat staged with the support of the United States in Kiev. So chloropyrin decomposes to form phosgene with the heat impact of a fire started by neo-Nazis who threw Molotov cocktails at protesters, which led to numerous casualties. An investigation conducted by Russian law enforcement agencies identified its perpetrators. However, it's not possible to achieve punishment for these people since they were eliminated by the Kiev regime's special services to conceal the circumstances of the tragedy in Odessa. So people who did have evidence of this chemical weapons being used in Odessa, Martin, apparently have been rounded up and killed by the Ukrainian special forces.
Well, that's right. The Ukrainian
secret police.
The Ukrainian regime has killed lots of people inside Ukraine, and you know, the Western media have completely ignored it. Zelensky is obviously not a neo-Nazi because he's in favour of gay rights, apparently. That's what MI6 informed us, the head of MI6. I don't know whether he's told the Azov battalion. Speaking of the Azov battalion, of course, they were absolutely smashed in this recent fighting in Avdiivka. They were sent in by the new commander, Sirsky, I think his name is, you know, and they arrived just in time to get walloped, completely walloped. And what's now about to happen is that we've got the Raputitsa period now where everything's going to be very muddy for a month or so. And once the ground gets harder, it could be that the Ukrainian army will disintegrate and the Russians will start to move into the territories which they've always claimed as their own, including Odessa, which will then link them up with the breakaway Republic of Transnistria, who've also asked for protection from the Russians. And of course, the Ukrainian army at that stage won't be able to stop them. If NATO turned up in dribs and drabs, they wouldn't be able to stop them either. If the whole British army of 70,000 people turned up at the current rate of kill that the Russians are getting there, they'd last a couple of months and then they'd all be dead.
Just to look briefly at what's going on here in the UK, I mean, we're looking a lot of the times at the foreign policy. I think we need to also understand just how evil our current government is when various individuals who are government working, you know, civil servants. This particular chap is, he was anyway, the head of the borders watchdog. His UK border force failed to check occupants of hundreds of private jets last year.
Hundreds of high-risk flights landed in the UK unchecked. Borders watchdog issues dramatic warning amid major new immigration scandal. Well, of course, this is the last thing that the government did. So what did? They just sacked the guy that said it. High-risk aircraft are landing in Britain without security checks in a major new immigration scandal. Borders watchdog warned of dangerous failings in prominent London airport. The London City Airport, which potentially allows thousands of passengers to evade passport controls. Data provided to independent Chief Inspector of Borders and Immigration, now sacked immediately, his name is David Neal, N-E-A-L, showed the UK Border Force failed to check the occupants of hundreds of private jets arriving at the London City Airport last year. The debacle means gangsters, illegal immigrants, trafficking victims and even extremists will have entered the UK without even rudimentary scrutiny. So as soon as he said that this is going on, another one of these sorts of airport is Northolt. Another one is Biggin Hill down in Kent. But the London City Airport, these are the sorts of airports where many of these private jets are landing. People are just hopping out of the jets, taking their luggage, walking straight out and with no checks at all, Martin.
Well, they're people like us, Tony. They're on private jets. The sort of people like Rishi Sunak, who doesn't use public jets. If he goes anywhere, he uses a private jet.
It's almost like
they're
this
people
is,
like us.
Yeah.
So there's nothing to worry about there, Tony.
This is gangsters. This is a mafia state, isn't it? This is London being the place that the perfect place for all these gangsters to congregate.
Well, that's right. That's what we are.
And so they sack the guy. So that's the first reaction of this government, is just to sack the person who's warning of this. So trying to protect the public? No. Anyway, so I thought that was fascinating. But it's very similar, in a way, to Harry Staunton, the former post office chairman. He's been saying this week in Parliament, talking about he was told to delay payouts to sub-postmasters. So, for daring to tell the truth, he is also sacked. And in fact, he even has the honour of having a condemnation by Kerry Badenoch, the minister, in Parliament. So what's happening is, as this government gets more and more corrupt towards the end of its tenure, so various civil servants, public guardians, are speaking out to the press and then being immediately sacked for their trouble, for exposing how awful things are here in the UK government. So in a way, it'd be good to see the back of this lot, wouldn't it? Is Starmer going to be any better?
Well, he's not going to be worse than that, but he's not going to be any good. And that's the problem, because we've actually got the biggest crisis since World War II.
Refused,
and we need somebody who knows what they're doing.
See, it was the Crown Prosecution Service, isn't it? He refused to prosecute Jimmy Savile. He prosecuted Julian Assange. You know, this is the kind of guy he is. So anyway, starting to wind up now. We have a couple of items. One is from John Gideon Hartnett. He's here talking about the King's cancer and genetic entropy. So what I will do is we'll have a listen to that, and then we'll hear, I think, from David Livingstone as he looks at, this is from last week's interview. You may have picked that up, the full interview, which I put up on the show page at thisweek.org.uk. And I'll do the same with this one from John Gideon Hartnett. This is really looking at the King's cancer and all sorts of spin-offs from that. Whether he really does have cancer, of course, we don't really know for sure. But assuming he does, what about cancer causes and cures, and particularly about this idea of genetic entropy, the idea that slowly but surely, as you get older, something goes on in amongst your genes and they slowly start falling apart?
From birth, we have two types of processes. One is, you could say, fighting against entropy, and the other one is the breakdown due to entropy. When we're young, the machinery in our body is sufficient to grow the body, and so the net result is growth and an increase of information, in a sense of, well, maybe not an increase of information, but an increase of complexity against that decay process. So the point being is the decay process is always there, right from conception. It's just the reverse machinery is working very well. And then as you get past about 20 years old, the ratios shift. You're more dying than you're growing, so to speak. So all body functions, all cells in your body are subject to this inexorable force of decay. And so every time a cell's copy, as you mentioned, the DNA has to be replicated. And occasionally there's a copying error. It's a mistake that doesn't get corrected by the internal machinery. Most are corrected, but there's a very small fraction of those that are not corrected, and they remain retained by your body. So per person in your life, roughly about 100 new mutations occur that you retain, and they are then passed on to your offspring. So to the cancer question, cancers arrive when a certain mistake accumulates that the repair mechanisms cannot correct, and or there are other reasons, of course, environmental changes, chemical environment, radiation, things that damage even the repair mechanism. And then the cancer cells, those that inherit, basically they inherit immortality because they're able to reproduce uncontrolled outside of that normal control mechanism in the body. And that can be merely the product of that random copying error, but I think there's a lot more to it than just that. The added, how would you say, added promoters of cancer are things that interrupt the immune system. For example, the immune system has killer T cells that roam around our bodies searching for those bad cells, those cancerous cells. And if you interrupt that in some way, then of course that creates conditions for the cancers to get out of control. Whether or not King Charles has cancer or not, he's what, 76 or something? That, you know, with age comes a loss in the innate immune system, and that means a loss in the ability to fight against those cancer cells that are constantly being produced in our bodies. So he may have something like that, and depending on, there are some treatments for cancer that do work. I'm talking about in the normal medical world, vast majority of them do not work, and there's a reason for that as well.
So that's John Gideon Hartnett. I mean, he also talks in the longer interview about ways to avoid cancer, and also does his own pretty good critique on the various different types of cancer treatment, whether they work or not. He's not a medical doctor, but he is very knowledgeable on many of these things. So I just thought it was useful and interesting if people want a kind of second opinion or third or fourth opinion to have John Gideon Hartnett talk about this kind of stuff. And as we know, we have the first UK patients receiving experimental mRNA therapy for cancer at the moment. So wouldn't it be interesting if King Charles is part of the promotion for that? So let's see. I mean, who knows? I don't know if he's actually been promoting it at all or what. Anyway, our final item this week is another clip from last week's David Livingstone. But this time I asked him much more to do with the whole idea of East versus West. Now, I've got my own quote from I was going to say Aleister Crowley, the famous Satanist, but actually no, it's from Sax Rohmer, who was a friend of Crowley's in this organisation called the Golden Dawn. But I'm a bit sceptical about whether or not Sax Rohmer, the writer, really believed in it. He lived in Reigate for many years. I think he was born in Birmingham, ended his days over writing over in the United States. He's famous for the Fu Manchu novels and films that spun off from those, some of which have got really nothing to do with the novel. But anyway, I think he was is more an acquaintance of Crowley, because he got some amazing tales from Crowley to weave into his novels. I'm not sure if he was a total believer in all that stuff, but anyway, he was certainly sharing many of Crowley's ideas with us in the Fu Manchu novels. But the point here is looking at this kind of competition between the East and the West. So the idea of the Golden Dawn being when the Eastern religions take over from the Western religions.
The Eastern religions are as mixed and varied as the Western religions. So there's Orthodox traditions and there's heterodox traditions, right? So what a lot of people don't realize is, for example, Tibetan Buddhism is very much a heretical branch of Buddhism. And probably not an accident why Western occultists picked it, particularly because of the influence of Tantra, which came from India. And what's called left-hand Tantra. So this is where you get this whole concept of what came to be known as the, or Martha Keys Shushart described it as, the Oriental Kabbalah. So in the time of Swedenborg in particular, Western occultists had begun to, basically Europe, in England in particular, with its conquest of India, had just started to discover Indian culture and Buddhism and Hinduism, and they discovered Tantra. So when they discovered it, particularly somebody like Swedenborg, who was practicing Sabbatian Kabbalistic sex rites, he thought what was an immediate similarity. So they concluded that there was such a thing as an Oriental Kabbalah, which preceded the Jewish Kabbalah. And this is how the whole idea of the Aryan race was developed, because the Aryan race were invented to provide a pedigree for this Jewish Kabbalah. So basically, the Aryans supposedly learned magic and mysticism from the fallen angels on Atlantis. And when Atlantis was destroyed, they escaped and landed in the mountains of Asia, either the Caucasus or whichever. And then they spread out from there. And they spread to India, they spread to Persia, and they spread to Europe, where they brought their language, which is now known as Indo-European, and they brought their culture. And so to Tibet, supposedly, they brought what was called Bon Shamanism, and then Bon Shamanism influenced Tibetan Buddhism. And so that's basically, this is the whole idea that Blavatsky adopted. And so this is why the original home of the Aryans was supposed to be this legendary place called Shambhala, which is interchangeable with Agartha, which is the land revered by the synarchists. So, you know, what's supposed to happen is that this primordial tradition, as they call it, is supposed to upend and supplant the monotheistic tradition, because, again, this is a Gnostic belief system. So they believe in the same Bible as you do, except they reread it in reverse. What's interesting is that this is mentioned in Dan Brown's book called The Lost Symbol. And the whole point is, after his, you know, all his books have all these ridiculous chases in it, the end of the chase is that finally they discover that the lost symbol of Freemasonry is the Bible. But he answers by quoting William Blake that it's not the Bible that every person reads, something along the lines of where you read black, I read white. So the idea is basically that they read the Bible in reverse, whereas the coming of the end times, the Antichrist is the hero who is going to war against the Messiah. And I mean, there's no prediction of the overthrow of the Messiah or the victory of Satan. So I don't know how they read it, but they have taken Satan's side, and they believe, that's the side they've taken. So basically, when what somebody like Aleister Crowley is trying to do is, we have to always remember that these are Satanists, so they have relinquished any kind of hold to to conventional morality, and they embrace immorality or amorality. So no crime is too awful. So that killing is innocent people, harming children, babies, the elderly, any level of deception, everything goes. So in fact, the worse it is, the more of an act of worship it is. So they will go at any length to try to advance their cause, and that cause is to overthrow God and to bring about this end time confrontation or Armageddon, to eventually get all of humanity to reject God and to accept you know, what's always been called the what synarchists call the primordial tradition. That's what Rene Guenot referred to it. It used to be called in the Renaissance the ancient wisdom. But really what it comes down to, it's the Kabbalistic religion based on the worship of Lucifer and the practice of magic. That's what the goal is, right? It's a Gnostic war. It's the it's not a war of believers against disbelievers. It's a war of believers against Gnostics. Two camps that both adhere to the same prophecy, but who choose a different side in the prophecy.
I think he does a pretty good job spelling it out, folks, if you haven't already got it. And I had a go, like I say, this week and Tuesday up at the old convent in Stroud with Project Libertas in trying to spell out this whole idea of accelerationism and this tug of war, really, that there is over the Book of Revelation, with some people seeing it as, you know, basically good versus bad, and the other saying it's bad versus good. In other words, the bad guy saying, well, actually, this needs to happen in order to get rid of some of these silly morals that have been put there by the monotheistic faiths of the Western faiths over the centuries. It's time to get rid of them, and it's a good thing too. That's what some of them say. And so they take the side of the Antichrist against God's people in that final battle. Anyway, fascinating. So anyway, if you're interested in that, I will put, like I say, a link up to it on our show page, just the audio of it, and maybe a link up to the some of the slides as well. And thanks very much for Project Veritas, or Libertas, Libertas it is, not Veritas, for inviting me to come and do a talk about accelerationists. I love challenges like this. It's like the Global Vision 2000 talk that we did, I think it was about 3 or 4 years. It was during the first year of the pandemic. I think it would be December 2020, where there was a whole load of people brought together by Moeen Yassin to do an online Zoom meeting all about this this stuff to do with the Islamic and the Jewish and Christian views of the end of the world. So fascinating stuff comes out when you start talking about those things, in my view. So time to sign off now. Thanks very much to our guest, Irish Republican Labour activist Martin Summers. Also to Steve Hall, the author of From the Northeast, author of The Death of the Left, which is a sad title, really. But anyway, it's a terrific book, and he really explains a lot of, particularly towards the end of it, it gets very positive. This is what we need to do to sort things out. And of course, we've got a bit of a message at 2 a.m. this morning about what needs to happen. And George Galloway is most definitely, along with people like Chris Williamson, a part of all that, and the Workers' Party. Let's see how they get on. Do please send me interviews and story tips via Not the BCFM Politics Show page. Also, thanks to our sound engineer, Dave Bazanko. You can download our MP3s to listen in the car or anywhere you like, and follow Tony Gosling Censored on Telegram, if you have Telegram. So you can subscribe to my weekly newsletter also, and even donate at thisweekoneword.org.uk. My paperbacks are two. They're available via the www.bilderberg.org website, in either an e-form, a paperback form, or if you want a free download with the degraded pictures on in them. They're mostly, I'm selling those on eBay, I'm afraid. So that's the two. There's The Traitors of Arnhem, about Martin Bormann and the Bilderberg Group. And also The Siege of Heaven, which is an anthology about secret government ever since Oliver Cromwell. and right the way up to the Princess Diana assassination, and beyond, in fact, the latest one. This show is repeated on 11 p.m. Fridays and 11 and 5 a.m. and p.m. all week on the PRSC stream here. That is to say, the talkradio.org.uk stream. We've been streaming live from the People's Republic of Stokes Croft and at radioqUK.com in Camberley, Surrey, and also live on the Not the BCFM Politics Show app. Do uninstall it and reinstall it if you wish. If you have any problems with it, that's the easiest way to beat them. If you can restream us live or rebroadcast us, just let me know and I'll credit you here. Have a relaxing and enjoyable weekend. Do please join us for Not the BCFM Politics Show at 5 o'clock next Friday. God bless. And don't let the satanic banksters get you down.
Another push, one novelty skips on. I'll take you. I'm only flesh and bones, no match for sticks and stones. Look under every home, he might be waiting.